Championship Wrestling, bringing you great wrestling action, sanctioned by the NWA, National Wrestling Alliance.
What they want.
That is true. All right, Retro NWA, October 3rd, 1987, the show after Ronnie Garvin's World Championship win against Ric Flair in the cage match in Detroit. They replayed the finish of that match, which ended last week's show. And they go to the studio, and the announcers are just giddy. They are beside themselves. They can barely wait to show everything. Garvin's new champ they're talking about. They're going to have more on that. Then they said Ricky Morton had suffered a separated shoulder and a concussion, and the Rock and Roll Express had lost the tag team belts.
But we're not going to tell you about that till next week.
Yeah, they left out the important detail of who won them.
Well, we figured it out.
It was answered shortly, but...
I mean, they didn't even need to tell us. I mean, it's been the feud.
I guess. I knew immediately. I thought it was a newsworthy thing that should have been included in there.
Well, that's why...
When there is a new champion, you should announce the... In fact, you should announce the new champion more than you should announce the old champions.
Well, you know, we found out who they were later, and you got to tune in next week to find out what happened.
Road Warriors versus Clement Fields and Ed Franks. So Hawk gets in there with Ed Franks. Now, we've seen a lot of shitty jobbers, just deadweight guys on these slams and lifts and stuff. I'm pretty sure Ed Franks was actively resisting. He was fighting back. He didn't want to go up. It didn't matter. Hawk's big and strong. You're going up, motherfucker. Pressing him for reps over his head. Throws him down. And eventually, they pin Fields. They did not do the Doomsday device. Maybe the studio roof is too small. Animal just held the guy in a bear hug, and Hawk hit a top rope clothesline, and that was that.
You know, Hawk did this promo afterwards where...
Yes.
If this was Raw in 2017, people would be calling for whoever wrote that to be fired. It was the most goddamn atrocious, fucking horrendous promo you've ever heard. And the only good thing I can say about it is he was the guy doing it. The one guy. Animal didn't do a promo like that. Tully didn't do a promo like that. Flair didn't do a promo. Nobody did. You had one guy doing a stupid promo. Now you got writers writing the same stuff for everybody.
That's true.
So it's up and down the show.
Plus...
But this was horrible.
I mean, this material was awful. But since he came up with it himself, at least he could deliver it passionately. He passionately told you, the viewer at home, that they, the Road Warriors, were neo-maxi-zoom dweebies, and everyone else was a clamhead.
That's what he said.
I'm not making any of this up.
No, I can't believe you even repeated it.
He also referred to Lex Luger as ex-Lax Luger, a reference that got Tony Schiavone totally off guard. And they plugged Starrcade, said we have a number of open contracts, and then they said we want to challenge Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson for the World Tag Team titles.
See?
Was that so hard?
No, he didn't.
Even in this terrible promo, Hawk was able to inform me what the announcers were not able to when they opened the show.
Oh, Vinny, get over it, buddy. Pay attention.
They showed the graphics, only the graphics.
That would be like saying, Ric Flair lost the world title, and you couldn't figure out who beat him. Hello, it's been a year and a half storyline.
There's no one else. He's been defending the world title against everyone in house.
Everybody knew that
we
was
watched
the big
these,
day.
We've watched these... There's lots of times in the show when a new champion just shows up at random, out of nowhere. They show the graphics, the video pack, not even the video packages, just the title screen for each of the previous Starrcades. The Gathering, Flair for the Gold, Skywalkers, whatever it was. Then we went to the Starrcade Control Center, which I love.
Tony's there, and he introduces Jim Crockett Jr. as, quote, not the president of Crockett Promotions. He said he was the, quote, president of the Wrestling Network. He said that twice on the show.
Yeah.
He's the president of the Wrestling Network. They cut to him. He's staring straight ahead in the creepiest manner possible. Absolutely unmoving. I thought it was a wax statue. And this entire Starrcade Control Center. Listen to me, everybody. It's the Starrcade Control Center.
It's the center.
We're getting the first big update for this year's Starrcade event. And he says, it's going to be in Chicago. It'll be called Chi-Town Heat. That was it.
That was it.
That was the fucking update? We had to go to the Starrcade Control Center with the president of the Wrestling Network to get that?
The best part is, he says this year's theme is going to be Chi-Town Heat. Tony was impressed. This was big news to Tony. This was different than, like, St. Louis Heat. Or Miami Heat. No, Chi-Town Heat. Tony was very impressed. I also liked when Tony said 1987 had been a huge year for pro wrestling all throughout the months. I guess he's not wrong. Terry Taylor versus Terry Jones. So Terry Taylor is beating him up and keeps teasing covers and picking him up at two.
You couldn't give Terry Jones a new name. I mean, seriously, he was a completely random jobber. We needed Terry versus Terry here.
At a week gone by, and they called him Mark Jones this week and Terry Jones next week, I would
nobody
not
would have noticed.
No.
Not one person.
Had to be Terry versus Terry.
If it was a guy with an interesting name as a jobber, like Tommy Angel or Mac McGiver, I mean, maybe you want to keep that name. But Terry Jones? Couldn't they just call him like T.J. Jones?
That
just get his
better.
Middle initial?
Yeah. So Terry Taylor's beating him up, and it gets to the point, it's a squash match, and he's getting the shit in, and it gets to the point where he's like, okay, now you should hit your finish and win this thing. And then he decides to work the leg. So then we get several minutes of boring toe holds and shots of bored women in the crowd. And finally, Terry wins the figure four. I mean, it was better than those terrible promos from the couch, but there was nothing about this that made me think Taylor was on Nikita Koloff's level. The heavyweight champion of the world, Ronald Garvin, appeared.
So, I don't know if this was the interview everybody's talking about.
We were warned.
I mean, maybe it would have been on the other shows last week.
Some people warned us, wait till you see this Ronnie Garvin promo. It's the worst thing you ever saw.
Not even close.
It was a Ron Garvin promo.
It was way better than Hawk.
That's true.
I mean, here's the problem. You want to know the problem with this, everybody? This was not a bad promo. But what this was Ron Garvin doing a promo.
It was not a Ric Flair promo.
It was not the world champion doing a promo.
Yeah.
And the bigger issue was later on this same show, Ric Flair did in fact do a promo. And it was a fucking phenomenal promo. The bigger issue, honestly, was not Garvin. It was Flair. And I'm not blaming Flair. I'm just pointing out that Flair came off as the champion. Ron Garvin came off as Jimmy Garvin's brother. And he had this big damn belt around his waist. I mean, it wasn't nearly as bad as people made it out to be.
He got one much worse than this a few months ago.
Oh, yeah. Way worse. I mean, it wasn't great. He said there's no feeling like winning the title.
I like when he said he would defend the belt anywhere on this green planet of ours. I don't care if it's a blue man, purple, black, yellow, or white.
He's very into colors.
Apparently.
We've learned that. Thank the fans. Flair got a hold of a real man, found out what that meant. He's going to defend the title all over the place against everybody who deserves a shot. Which, by the way, he didn't do.
No, but he did say Flair would have to wait in line.
Yep.
Yep.
He said Flair went after his brother's woman and told people he was going to put Ronnie out of wrestling. Didn't happen. Space Mountain is closed. He said, everybody, call somebody and tell them that Ron Garvin is the world's champion and will be for a long time to come. Yeah.
It was a Ron Garvin promo. I don't know what you want. It's like you getting mad at me for expecting something else from a Young Bucks match.
Well, the problem, Vinny, is it's 2017 now.
Mm-hmm.
And you're used to every fucking geek being the champion, including Jinder Mahal, who couldn't even speak for like the first 3 months of his title reign for some reason. He was all scratchy and raspy and had nothing to say. I mean, back then, like, the world champion did not do promos like this.
No.
You were used to Dusty and Flair, and here was Ron Garvin.
Guy
in his way through this promo.
Yeah. Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson versus Mike Force and Tommy Angel.
Man, the belts looked awesome on these guys.
Yeah.
Big gold belts, praying around with those things on. It took me back to when I was a kid, and somebody would win the belts, and they'd come out with the new belts on. It was awesome.
I liked Arn out there in his red and yellow gear. A secret alliance with Hulkamania must be coming.
My favorite spot in this match was Tully decides he's going to give Tommy Angel a spot. Tommy Angel hits a big drop kick. And Tully takes his giant bump. The crowd goes crazy. Tommy Angel has no goddamn idea what to do next.
He's never been on offense before in his life.
He stands up. He awkwardly puts up his fists. He backs off. Tully makes his way all the way to his own corner. Then he just stands there and looks at Arn. I mention this because I used to do this with Buddy all the time. When I first started, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't want to mess anything up. He'd say, 1-2, which means he gives me one. I spin him around, I give him two.
Uh-huh.
And then I just stand there. What the fuck do I do now? And I back up, and he'd just sit there. And then finally we just lock up again. I was Tommy Angel.
That's right. That's right. So, despite that, Tully must have seen something in Tommy Angel he liked, because he gave Tommy Angel way more offense than you would think for a guy facing the brand new tag team champions of the world. And then eventually he had enough. He threw Tommy Angel outside, which almost killed him there. Arn rubs Tommy Angel's face into the cement, which you recall was a big angle with Ricky Morton that kicked off a feud with Ric Flair. And then throw him back in the ring. And Tully grabs Tommy Angel, and perhaps thinking he's an actual angel and trying to send him back to heaven, he grabs him for a pile driver. And then he can't decide whether to drop him on his head or on his face. So he just kind of goes down, and I'm still not sure. I watched this over and over and over again. I made a GIF of it. I put it on a loop. I studied this. I still don't know if Tommy Angel landed on his face or the top of his head. Either way, it sucks. I laughed and I laughed and I laughed. And then shortly thereafter, they pinned him. He hits this move, and he drops the guy in his head. And they tried like one more thing and realized, I've knocked him loopy. And they threw him to the corner to tag his partner in until he hit Mike Force with the slingshot suplex. And that was that. J.J. Dillon and Lex Luger cut a promo.
Oh, man. Lex Luger cut a better promo than Ron Garvin.
That's true.
Told Ronnie, don't even bother engraving your name on the front of that belt because I guarantee Flair's going to win it back at any time.
That's true.
Barry Dusty
says,
this man's trying to win with an out-and-out illegal choke hold. And J.J. Dillon is going to look into the legal ramifications of this. And until this legal issue is settled, I'm going to wrestle everybody except Dusty.
And beat them.
Yes.
He was sure to add that. I will wrestle anyone else in the world and beat them. But I won't wrestle Dusty until we get this illegal finish taken care of. And he's done, and it was awesome. And then J.J. says, by the way, I'm retired from wrestling. But I want everyone to know I'm getting pretty sick of Johnny Weaver.
It was even better. He says, Johnny Weaver, I'm retired from wrestling, but I've just about had it with you. That was the line.
Yeah.
I've just about had it with you. And he says it on the way out.
Yeah.
This is so what's missing in wrestling nowadays. He's so overconfident. Like, every single fan watching this knew instantly, man, if Johnny Weaver ever got his hands on J.J. Dillon, he would fuck him up. But J.J. Dillon, his character believes, man, I'd wipe the floor with that Johnny Weaver.
No question.
It's so awesome.
And I'm sure on cities around the world, Johnny Weaver wiped the floor with J.J. Dillon. It was great.
Just about had it with you. That was like the best line on the whole show. Like, this is what I'm talking about. J.J. Dillon had one line, okay? All I wanted in this world was to see J.J. Dillon versus Johnny Weaver. That one line. It was so great. I couldn't get over it. I watched it over and over again.
Jim Crockett comes out for an interview after the Starrcade Control Center. He has to beg the fans, please stop overwhelming our phone callers with questions about ticket info. Our phone department's overwhelmed with phone calls coming in. Please stop calling. Tickets are going to go on sale Monday, October 12th. Next week we'll give you info on all the computer locations where you can buy tickets.
Oh, man. I can only imagine those locations.
I actually do remember this, going to like Pay and Save, because they had the Ticketmaster computer.
Oh.
Whew. Yeah. Lex Luger versus Mac MacGyver.
Mac McGiver. Not Giver.
Did it say G-I-V-E-R? I just assumed it must be Giver.
No, Mac McGiver.
Mac McGiver.
I was so unbelievably disappointed when I actually saw him. He was just a normal-looking kind of fat guy. With a name like Mac McGiver, I was just hoping for the jobberest jobber that ever jobbed. He's just a guy.
He was a guy. He had some girth to him, like he played football or weightlifting. He was a big fella. Not Lex Luger big, but a big fella. Hopefully he could survive a beating. Very flabby. Very, very generic. He was a perfect heavyweight jobber.
I don't know if Luger didn't trust him or what, but he didn't even rack him.
No.
He just squeezed him.
He puts in the bear hug and says, I don't need to do the backbreaker. And Mac McGiver gave up to the bear hug. That was that.
It was very funny. They locked up at the beginning, and then Luger pushed him off, and then Luger screams at him, don't crowd me. So I don't know if that was like part of his gimmick, like he was saying that as Lex Luger, or if he was saying it as Larry. Like, get the hell out of my way, buddy. You're crowding me when I'm trying to flex my muscles.
Yeah. Hey, Ric Flair may have lost that world championship, but he's still got his random music video every week.
Hey.
Dusty Rhodes comes out for a promo.
The very first thing he says is he's talking about Jim Crockett Jr., who had been out there for the Starrcade Control Center. And he told us, the viewers, that Jim Crockett Jr. I want you all to go back and watch the show before you hear what I'm about to say. He said he was looking so dandy and so fine.
Yeah.
Let me tell you one thing. When I saw Jim Crockett Jr. earlier in the show, staring at the camera, unmoving like a wax statue, the two fucking words that did not enter my mind were dandy and fine.
So Dusty starts talking about War Games as a Jim Crockett original. Everything else you see is just a bad copy. If you're wondering what he was talking about, WWF was about to debut Survivor Series, another team-based match. So he congratulates Ronnie Garvin on his win, but also warns him to train harder than ever before. Now there's a target on him. He is the hunted, not the hunter. But he congratulates Garvin again, says, hey, you are on the short list of men who have defeated Ric Flair for the world title. But I've done it twice. Because he's Dusty.
Just got to make sure we get that in there.
Yeah, yeah. He threatens Luger, warns Dillon not to mess with Weaver, hypes up Koloff and Taylor a bit, and then threatens to bust up Luger and Charlotte tonight.
He notes the Weaver lock is deadly and says that's a serious threat from Dusty Rhodes. Sounds like it.
I guess so.
It's deadly.
Ivan Koloff and the Warlord versus Keith Steinborn and Bob Riddle.
Keith Steinborn is my favorite awful jobber in years.
He's so bad.
He's so hideous.
He's skinny fat. He's pale. He's got a black singlet with KS on the ass, just so it doesn't get stolen, I guess. And then it's black, right? It's supposed to be slimming.
It's got that red.
It has a red waistband.
Yeah, belly band.
A belly band.
They called it in gymnastics.
It's a red stripe going around his gut and at the fattest point to emphasize how fat he is.
Yeah.
Did we mention his mullet? He's this huge, huge long mullet. Bob Riddle is out
there. He's horrifying. He's Horatius.
I forgot about
Bob
Riddle.
That's the new word I invented today on Observer Live. He's Horatius.
Bob Riddle is in zebra striped tights and a white top.
He was dressed like Saltador in Lucha Underground. He was just
unmasked.
That's
true. I compared him to an in-shape Sandman, just gear-wise. I guess it was actually
Sandman.
Yeah, Sandman used to wear like the Zubas with the white.
Oh, yeah, the old Zubas. This was not Zubas, though. This was tights.
This was tights, but they had the same color scheme. So these guys are so horrible. The second best wrestler in this match was the Warlord. He beat the hell out of Steinborn. You know what? I apologize to all of you. I've neglected to write down the finish.
I'll tell you about it.
Was it a power slam?
First off, number one, Paul Jones is doing commentary. So excited about the Mighty Wilbur coming.
That's
out.
Also true, yes.
He cannot wait. He says, I wanted to get my army together before Starrcade, and now I'm ready for anything. And then Warlord won with the power slam.
Okay, I was right, yes. And then they beat the hell out of Steinborn afterwards. I don't know why. I kept waiting for the Road Warriors or Nikita or somebody to come out to fight them. Nope. Keith Steinborn sucks, and he has no friends. Flair comes out for a promo.
This guy's dressed to the nines. He's got the most amazing pair of sunglasses. So all I could look at was like, where can I get a pair of sunglasses like that? They look like a million-dollar pair of sunglasses. He says, Ronnie Garvin puts the guy over like $1 million. You know you're good. I know you're good. Everybody knows you're great because you worked for Jim Crockett. You were fighting for the world title. And most importantly, you beat Ric Flair. But now you're the hunted. You have to wrestle Animal, Hawk, Nikita, Dusty, the Horseman. You're a marked man. You can't turn your back for a minute. The days of getting 8 hours sleep a night. Now you're going to get maybe two because you're going to be worried every night that you won't be the champ tomorrow. What are you going to tell your girlfriend when you're no longer the champion? And his conclusion, Ric Flair says, these are his exact words, I will not be the only rooster in Jim Dillon's henhouse not producing eggs.
That's what he said, yes.
Can I repeat that?
Sure, I've had it.
Sometimes I try to repeat these things and I do too good a job. There's no way, there's one, even The Rock could not have got away with this line. I will not be the only rooster in Jim Dillon's henhouse not producing eggs.
There's a lot of problems with this.
How the fuck did he pull that line off?
I don't know.
But he did! And he said, number two, I'm still going to kiss all the girls and make them cry.
That's also
this
true.
Was the most unbelievably great promo since last week.
Since every other Ric Flair promo. He said all of that. He also said, all the medals and honors you won in the past won't buy you a drink in this country. He said he knew what it was like to pay $100 for a manicure or for a cigar. Being world champion was part of his life. Warned Garvin, every promoter in the world is going to have a surprise for you. You arrive at the building and find out, oh, it's a cage match tonight. Oh, what's that? Now I'm doing a chain match? Okay. And then he vowed to kiss the girls and make them cry. This promo was a direct, unfiltered look into the heart of Ric Flair.
It was awesome.
It's amazing.
It's why he was the champ.
It's why he was Ric Flair. That's why he was the Nature Boy.
It was so abundantly clear here. This is not news, by the way. I'm not the first person to say this. I may be the last person to say this. Flair was the best choice to be the fucking champion of the world.
Uh-huh.
Without even, there's no one even close.
No.
God, he was great.
Dusty Rhodes' music video. It was just him doing entrances and walking down the aisle.
That's the highlights.
I guess that's the highlights of Dusty. Terry Taylor came out for a promo. Says he had come all the way to Nikita Koloff's backyard to get his attention.
He's a heel, by the way. The girls are just screaming, just in love with Terry Taylor.
Yes, that's true.
But my God, was he ever the Miz here?
I thought the same thing.
It was the same deal. He cut the most unbelievable heel promo. I didn't believe a word he said. But you know what? The Miz is 1,000 times better talker.
Miz is a better talker. Terry's a better wrestler. But they are totally similar.
Yeah.
It's not just the Red Rooster haircut the Miz used to have.
No.
They're the same guy. Yeah, so what Taylor says is he's come to Nikita's backyard to get his attention, blames Nikita for hiding behind NWA executives and Jim Crockett refusing to sign a contract to face him, and then, of course, Nikita's out there for his match. It's Nikita Koloff versus El Negro.
For?
Thank you.
The United States title.
World Television Championship.
World Television title. I always screw that one up.
Yeah.
But still, it doesn't matter.
It's a championship.
How was El Negro in line for a championship match? Tell me this.
Well, he's not now. Nikita won in 30 seconds with a sickle.
I hope the championship committee takes a good long look at who they're putting in these championship matches.
Clearly,
after this one.
He needs stiffer competition. So he dares Taylor to get in the ring, and they start brawling. David Crockett living and dying with every punch in this random, unsanctioned brawl.
You know what's funny about this brawl? It was like, it was a great, horrible brawl.
I think I get what you're saying.
They just had the worst brawl you've ever seen. There was one double leg by Nikita. It was so sloppy. They did one high spot where they were on separate pages.
Yes. When they were just down on the mat throwing punches, fine. When they started running the ropes and doing stuff, no bueno.
I think it was Taylor who hit the ropes, but whoever hit the ropes had to run like in an orbit around their opponent because their opponent was in the middle of the ring.
Yes.
As opposed to stepping away, so you just have to run straight down the middle.
This was negative chemistry.
Yes. And then Eddie Gilbert hit the ring and they doubled
teamed.
And
he was
Nikita.
Late, by the way, so Nikita and Terry had to stand there with time frozen until Eddie hit the ring. They whipped Nikita's ass. They left him lying. They stole Nikita's belt to prove
Ooh.
to prove we are the world's television champion. Where's Dusty?
Hell if I know.
Why is he not watching his friends back?
Back showering.
So they leave with both belts. Nikita comes to, goes to the announce desk. Where'd they go? Where'd they go?
Who are they? That's his other question. Who was that, he says.
He starts throwing furniture around. Now, I will say this. They've been doing this, building up to this for like a month now, and I have... when it started, there was zero part of me that saw Terry Taylor and Nikita Koloff's level. It's been a month. I still don't see Terry Taylor as being at Nikita Koloff's level, but there's a part of me, there's a little spark in me that can't wait to see Nikita beat his ass and prove that he's not on Nikita's level. Hey, that's something. This feud has some mojo.
And you know what? Despite the wacky, sloppy brawl, it was a good little angle. Because they don't do a million angles on every show.
That's true.
This was just a nice, simple angle to end the show and make you want to see this match. I thought the show was great.
It was a very fun show.
Very fun show.
And there will be gorilla shit all over the army.
Well, let's do this NWA show. How many of these do you watch, Tom? Do you watch it regularly?
Zero.
Have you ever watched it before?
No.
Really?
No.
In your life, have you ever watched these before?
No.
See, this is... We've now hit the part here where this is the shows where I really started watching wrestling, or maybe a few months away. So this is the stuff that got me hooked.
I'm a few years younger, so...
You're quite a few years younger.
Yeah, I'd say what I really watched was like Saturday Night. That's what really got me hooked, was WCW Saturday Night.
That's kind of what this
basically,
is.
Basically, this show turned into that.
Yes.
Well, yeah, I know, but this is well before...
But yes, you were watching the
Hogan era?
90s. So...
Yeah.
No, before that.
Before that, okay.
I watched it before Hogan got there, probably like a year or two before he
So like Sting and Vader.
91, 92, 93.
Yeah, the Black Scorpions.
Oh, my God.
That's probably the first storyline I remember. So when is that? Like 90?
That's like somewhere around there.
91 or so.
Yeah, I think I had a magazine
okay.
from that time. And like I actively remember. But I also remember watching on ESPN, whatever was on there.
AWA.
And Global.
Yeah, but wasn't there like a mix and then it became like UWF?
They had AWA, they had Global, they had Legends of World Class for a while.
So. Okay, yeah. See, I probably watched all those. There was one where like, I want to say Jeff Jarrett got ethered or something. And that's the one I remember the most.
USWA might have been on ESPN? I don't
That's
really
what
remember.
I thought too. I thought it was USWA, but then when I went and looked back, it was... The history was kind of muddy, but whatever.
Well, this show here, October 10th, 1987.
Black Scorpion was 1990, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah. God, Tom was like zero.
So the show opens with...
It's like MLW.
Yeah.
They kind of went back in time with this, because last week, Tully and Arn were tag team champions with little information on how that happened. They explained it all this week.
Well, they promised last week. They said, next week, we're going to tell you what happened with the tag team titles.
That's true. So there you go.
Ironically, Tony Schiavone opened up the show much like he opened up the MLW show.
That's crazy.
Doing commentary. Same haircut.
Really?
Just no mustache now.
That's he should grow back for those MLW shows.
The mustache?
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Quick random thought. We're talking about Tony Schiavone and old NWA shows. I was watching an interview the Hardys did after their appearance at Starrcade this year. And they, of course, they're from the Carolinas, so it's part of their history and heritage. And they're talking about watching the old Starrcade. And, of course, there was a line in there where Jeff Hardy says something about, man, I'd like to bring the Skywalkers back.
Oh, God, get out of here.
He quickly shot it down himself. But, right. Yeah, only Jeff Hardy would think that. So this show opens. It's Jim Cornette and the Midnight Express. They're confronting Jim Crockett. They want a match against the Rock and Roll Express. And Cornette begins to insult Ricky Morton's dad. Nothing but a drunk. He goes off at him for a while. Morton walks up and he says something, but then he just slaps Cornette in the face. And Cornette does the second funniest thing I ever saw with his hilarious shocked bump. I mean, he got hit and fell down. He got hit by a professional athlete and fell down. But it was more the shock that someone had the audacity to slap him in the face like this than the actual
Can you believe you'd make fun of someone's dad and call him a drunk, and the guy'd show up and slap you?
That's amazing.
What an asshole.
Well, on the same
How note, dare he?
The greatest thing I ever saw was actually Stan Lane in this, because he was even more shocked than Cornette was. Like, it was so clearly a trap on their part to pick a fight, But when the fight got picked, they were caught totally off guard. Lane's jaw drops, his eyes bug out, and he freezes. He can't even move. He can't defend his manager. He's so surprised.
All I could think watching this was, I hope these NWA Pro Wrestling shows end up on the network someday. That's a lot of footage we could sink our teeth into.
That's some good stuff there. Opener was Lex Luger versus Ricky Nelson.
Ricky Nelson looked like Lex's 10-year-old brother.
Lex had a line in here where he demanded an opponent that weighed more than 200 pounds. He threw...
You better not hit the current indie scene.
No.
He'd have no opponents.
He'd have to face tag teams.
He wouldn't even have you, would he, Tom?
Yeah, I'm over 200. I've actually started putting weight on.
Mm.
Because I separated my shoulder and I can't do anything. So.
Oh, that's true.
That sucks.
Man, that's the opposite of what happened with Jinder. That's weird. Go ahead, Vinny.
So he
separated the shoulder. I won the belt.
Well, that's also the opposite of what happened with Jinder.
Lex threw him around, pressed him, choked him, won with a torture rack. That was it.
Yeah.
Camera kept cutting to women in the crowd who were either disinterested or just wanted to look away.
This is a common thing, too. Maybe it's only these shows, but they want their guys to be sex symbols. So they keep cutting to women in the crowd, hoping these women will be flirting, I guess, or just taking it back, fanning themselves, perhaps. And usually, yes, they just look kind of there.
Well, it's live. So, like, unlike
UFC does it better.
Unlike in WWE or UFC, where you've got, like, 10,000 people there, there's probably, like, 100.
Maybe.
Almost no women.
Maybe less.
And it's like, let's get a shot and just pray.
Just
one,
find
it. 1, 2, 3, hit it!
There's six women in this.
Fuck.
There's six women in this building. Film one of them. They showed Terry Taylor stealing Nikita Koloff's NWA World TV title last week.
Did you notice Harry Dunn was refereeing?
No.
I did not notice Harry Dunn.
Should I know who that is?
Go ahead.
We'll move on.
Everyone should.
Okay. So
this is a common theme on this show, Vinny.
Yes, so. So Terry steals Nikita Koloff's NWA World TV title belt, and here's Jim Crockett to respond. And Jim says, well, I know the UWF president, and he names him, but I forget. But he was an active NFL football player who Bill Watts used as his commissioner because Bill Watts is a football mark.
Jim Ayers or something?
John Ayers.
John Ayers is out there.
A total figurehead
role. But
are you a football guy, Vinny?
I am, but I'm less a football guy of 1987.
Yeah, this was 1987, dude.
I was 12.
Yeah.
So,
by the way, Jim Crockett is now, ever since, for the last like 2 weeks now, Jim Crockett has been the president of the Wrestling Network.
Somebody answered this, because they were in the process
merged.
Of buying or merging UWF, yes. Whatever, and so the Wrestling Network was both of them.
Yes.
Yeah. So, I don't think it lasts long.
So he says
Did it turn into Evolve?
No. It did not, in fact, evolve into Evolve. So, correct me if I'm wrong here, but I believe he said, I am going to write a letter.
No, he has already sent a registered letter to John Ayers demanding that the heels return the belt.
No. John Ayers demanded that they return the belt.
No, John Ayers is the head of the UWF. The UWF guys stole Jim Crockett's belt.
I think that John Ayers demanded they return the belt.
Well, one way or the other, they need to return this belt. That's the key, as we'll get to.
But...
I'm curious.
Crockett says, I wrote a letter. Hopefully the belt gets returned. And if not... He didn't really have any follow-up to that.
No.
I'll write another letter?
If not, you're going to get it.
I'll break out the red pen? J.J. Dillon comes out for a promo. This was so awesome.
J.J.'s got to go into the Hall of Fame.
This was the best thing ever. So I'll explain what happened first, and then kind of talk about how they showed it here. So earlier, we talked about the footage where the Midnight Express picked a fight with the Rock and Rolls. Later on that show, the Rock and Rolls have a title defense against the Four Horsemen, but as they are making their entrance, the Midnights come out and attack Ricky Morton and lay him out, shot to the head, and the divorce court on the floor.
What is that?
Separating his shoulder. It's if you were chest to chest with a guy and you wrapped around their left arm and then just took a back bump and he took a front bump and sold it like he destroyed his shoulder.
It's in some of the WWE video games as the single arm DDT because the person people making the games didn't know what it was supposed to be.
Well, people used to use that in like the Attitude Era.
Sure.
Yeah.
Like, but, maybe Edge?
Sure. But yeah, it's supposed to be, it's called that, the divorce court, because it separates your shoulder. That's what it's
separates.
Supposed to be.
Got it?
Yeah.
Separates.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
You're welcome.
So, JJ's in the studio, and he here is 100% professional, and as he's speaking, if you were not familiar with this, you would think he's being totally reasonable. And everything he said sounded like a good logical point.
He's the smarmiest, slimiest heel.
He was a lawyer, is what he was here.
He had no idea. He couldn't even see what was going on.
Well, it was very unfortunate, he says, what happened to Ricky Morton.
Yes, they were in the ring.
We were in the ring. Fans were jumping up and down. We couldn't really see. We were preparing for a world title match. Our adrenaline was through the roof. So, apparently there was some sort of attack with the Midnight Express. And they come to me saying, Mr. Dillon, can we delay this match? Can we postpone this match? And, hey, what happened to Mr. Morton? It's unfortunate, but it is not my problem. It is not our fault.
We got a valid contract.
We have a contract stipulating a world tag team title match right now. There is no reason for us to be forced to forfeit our title shot. So before they can settle it, Robert Gibson hits the ring with both title belts and settles it for everyone, and he just accepts the match. He'll fight on his
own. Geek of the week, baby.
So, Gibson starts fighting by himself for a while. And they go back to Dillon. He says, I'm very proud of Robert Gibson. It was a very courageous, valiant effort he put up. Fighting two men. Going for those early pins, trying to get a flash pin. But a victory like that is very hard to get over men the caliber of Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson. So I'm at ringside watching this match. I'm getting sketchy reports on the conditions of Ricky Morton. I hear he has a shoulder injury. I hear he has a head injury. But I can't really confirm any of these because I'm at ringside handling this match. And then I was as surprised as anyone when I saw what happened next.
Now, Tom, when you went to this MLW show, did you have your shoulder taped up like Ricky Morton did when he came out here?
No.
This guy was a fucking mummy. He's wrapped head to toe.
I thought it was a sling.
Dude. It was a bandage, but he tied him up like it was a sling. So Ricky Morton runs out with one arm.
One arm man in an ass-kicking contest.
And he tags himself in. Gibson doesn't tag, and Ricky reaches in, and he demands to fight. And Ricky hits the ring, and he'll throw a punch with his good arm and then stop and sell his bad arm. And he'll throw a punch with his good arm and stop and sell his bad arm. All the other baby faces come out. At first, I thought to cheerlead, but no, they were concerned for Morton's long-term safety. He may have suffered a career-ending injury here. He had no business being in this ring. So they're all trying to talk him into stopping the match. The horsemen eventually cut him off. They tear the bandages off. They do a couple double teams, but then Arn just puts him in an arm bar, like you see in every other horseman match ever. And Ricky's screaming in pain and screaming, and finally, Gibson hits the ring. He submits on Morton's behalf. He can take no more.
He surrendered.
He's too brave to give up on his own, but I cannot stand by and let my partner risk his career.
My God, I wept.
Great story.
So it was an awesome finish, except for one thing that drove me nuts. It's a fucking no DQ match. What's everyone standing on the apron for? Why didn't Robert get in there and help his buddy?
They did a lot of these no DQ matches where no one did anything anyway.
Yeah, hated it.
Weird.
Just pretend that didn't happen.
They go back to the
studio. Well, maybe you can't win when the other guy's in there.
They go back to the studio. Actually, that may be true.
We learned that you can lose in a no DQ match when you're in the ropes, so fuck if I know, dude.
But that's part of the field of play.
No, it's...
I don't even know what the hell the argument is.
You're back in the studio. Dillon says, when Morton hit the ring, of course, everyone knew he was hurt, including the horsemen. And the horsemen are not going to apologize for being opportunists and doing what it takes to win championships. Now we're back on top of the pile, and he has a mighty cackle. But the whole time he's talking, the fans are chanting rock and roll, rock and roll. And he cackles, and he stops, and he scowls at them. Because he's the best. This segment was awesome. Speaking of awesome segments, it's time for the Starcade Control Center.
Closed circuit, baby. 100 cities.
More than 100 cities around the
nationwide
country.
Nationwide will be providing the show. You can go anywhere and see this on closed circuit, they said.
They showed the finish of the Garvin Flair title match again. They announced a new match for the show.
The only match official at this point.
I believe so, yeah. Steve Williams defending the UWF title against Barry Windham.
That's right.
Yeah, UWF champ against the number one contender, the Western States.
Western champ. States Heritage Champion.
Yes.
Who was the Eastern States Champion?
I don't know.
Was there one?
There was not one.
Hmm.
So
there was no heritage in the East. Only the West.
Shit, that's where all the heritage is. Come on, give me a break.
So the whole time the camera has showed Shivani and Crockett, and then they switch cameras, and you realize J.J. Dillon has been there the whole time. And he essentially says that, without outright saying it, he says Flair's going to challenge Ronnie Garvin at Starrcade. But more importantly, he says he knows Crockett wants to book a U.S. title defense with Lex Luger defending the belt against Dusty Rhodes. He promises if Crockett tries to get that match booked, his lawyers will present a very long list of demands. And Crockett basically says, fine. He doesn't care. Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson versus Alan Martin and Bob Riddle.
Look at that, Matt Riddle's dad.
I'd also like to add that they called this the granddaddy of them all.
Yeah.
Starrcade.
Granddaddy of them all.
Squash
match.
Yeah, Matt Riddle's dad. Not quite. These bums wouldn't even make it into NWO WCW Revenge.
Wow.
I believe Arn shoot DDT'd one of these guys at one point. So, JJ goes to commentary and says, folks, very excited. Tully and Arn have a new move, and they're going to debut it right now. And the new move is just a double gourd buster. Arn's been doing this by himself for years. Now Tully does it at the same time.
Works for me.
All right. They do this move, and David Crockett says, wow.
So can I talk about this Ron Garvin promo?
Double gourd buster?
Yeah. So
can we not talk about this promo?
Listen, I've been very complimentary of Ron Garvin. This fucking promo absolutely just utterly sucked. This was so bad. Everybody was talking about last week's promo. What about this promo? He says he was the hunter. Now he's the hunted. That was it.
It took him like three minutes.
He couldn't even name the UWF. He screwed it up. Called it a UWA or something. Like he's fucking going to Mexico. Mumbled through his promo.
Well, he's world champion.
It sucked. It was virtually the same promo that Ric Flair did last week, except Flair did it, I mean, what, a trillion times better?
Maybe a trillion.
I mean, can I go higher than that? A quadrillion times better? This was the goddamn worst promo on this whole show. In weeks and months, maybe.
He claimed he was fighting for $1 billion.
Dude.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
He meant a million, I presume. This sucked.
The Road Warriors defeated David Isley and Larry Stevens with just a lariat.
Two jobbers who sucked.
Oh, Bo Dallas.
He did not do...
Murdered.
The Doomsday Device. They didn't do the... even the elevated clothesline they did last week. Animal just hit a lariat and won. And they show this lariat in slow-mo. I'm not sure which of these jobbers it was, but man, them titties were flying.
God, it was terrible. It was horrible.
He got hit straight in the face with the clothesline.
By like, Road Warrior Animal.
Oh my God.
It's a sad day.
This is the way things used to be, Tom, in these enhancement matches.
You got to get yourself over at all costs.
Yeah.
Including the neck of the other guy.
And the other guys didn't know how to work.
Paul Ellering threatened gang violence against the Four Horsemen in order to get a title shot.
Yeah.
They did a promo. Animal said, we're going to defend our six-man titles. And Hawk said, we met the World Series champion Minnesota Twins. They said, we'll be world champion soon. And Paul says, I listened to that Horseman promo. And the Horsemen, they got a championship by hiring the Midnight Express to take out the Rock and Roll Express. Maybe you will do that.
Man. We're talking about this Eddie Gilbert Menace gimmick here.
Eddie Gilbert wrestled the Menace.
So listen, I love this show because they don't do a bunch of shit that insults my intelligence. This totally insulted my intelligence. Eddie Gilbert's out there with the stolen belt.
Yeah.
Where is Crockett? Where is Nikita? Where is the entire babyface locker room to come and just grab the belt and take it back? Where's anybody? Why do we have a registered letter being sent to some football player when these guys are out here on the television show in the studio with the belt? So that's stupid. The match sucks. My favorite part, you know the spot where a guy's down by the ropes and you put your foot on his neck and then you grab the ropes so that you can put more pressure on the guy's neck? And he's doing that, and he just lets go of the ropes and falls on his ass. In the middle of this enhancement match. This sucked. I'm so disappointed in the Menace. I want him to be even worse.
The only time it was really obvious he was terrible is when he was running the ropes.
Yeah.
Ric Flair came out for a promo.
Have I mentioned this guy's the greatest promo there's ever been in professional wrestling? Or ever will be?
There have been 1 million or more crazy Ric Flair promos. If there were 10 crazier than this, I'd be surprised.
There are probably 100 crazier.
I mean, I know there are, but still. He begins, he's slightly calm, relatively. He takes off his shoes, shows his fancy leather shoes with a buckle, and says, 2 weeks ago, Ronnie Garvin, you would not be able to afford these shoes. Now you can, but you'd never be able to fill them.
Oh, man, he's just ruining this guy.
He says he liked walking out on TV with a championship belt around his waist because that's how you could tell who the winners were in the sport and because it added 3 or 4 zeros to your paycheck. He begins to tear his shirt open, demands the camera zoom in on his chest.
I think he's trying to show off a scar that he got from Garvin Chops.
I presume.
Which I am sure is real.
But he's so tan.
And he's going so nuts. I mean, he's running around like an idiot.
Yeah.
There's no way to zoom in.
He then steps out in front of the audience. Why? Because he's Ric Flair. He explains that Garvin's going to learn what a lot of blondes have learned.
He says, just like so many good-looking blondes that have fallen by the wayside, Ronnie's not going to be there long.
No. It's one thing, he says, to climb on Space Mountain. It's another thing to ride it.
That's right. And pretty soon, he's going to get off his back.
Yeah.
Quit enjoying the pleasurable part of his relationship.
That's what he said.
And he's going to turn over and take Ronnie Garvin home. What?
He said
Did Iron Sheik write this?
He says this. We rewound it to double check we weren't confused. That's what he said. And he just keeps going. And he's ranting, and he's screaming, and he's spitting, and his eyes are bugging out. And I can barely understand what he's saying. And he's mid-sentence, he stops, he turns to the crowd, he screams, "Shut up!" And he walks away.
And he's done.
He mid-sentence.
99.9% of Flair promos, he wraps up. But this time, he was so out of his mind that he just short-circuited and ran off screen. This was unreal. And it's, like I've said before, when Flair's the champion, he goes out there and he just has fun. And he laughs, and he makes fun of people, and he's the nature boy. When he does not have the championship, he is 100% dead serious on getting it back.
Yes.
That's the only thing in the world that matters because he's not Ric Flair when he's not the world champion. And he cannot handle not being Ric Flair. God, he was amazing. I hope you were taking notes, Tom.
Still is.
Tully and Arn come out for a promo. Tully starts. As he's talking, Arn's behind him in glasses with a big, thick book. So Tully talks about how in the Super Bowl, Lawrence Taylor played hurt. He taped up his ankle. He took a shot at something. And he went out there, and he played hurt, and he won a championship for his team. That's what Arn and I did. We're hurt. We didn't make excuses like Ricky Morton. We fought through our pain. We triumphed despite the injuries, and we didn't make any excuses. So they go to Arn. Arn then reads the definition of adversity from the dictionary and explains...
That's a book they've got, a dictionary.
Yeah, I found a dictionary here in the studios. And explains that Tully and Arn are tag team champions because they overcame adversity. And then Rock and Roll Express are not champions because they failed to overcome adversity. And he's talking about how important these titles are. And the most important thing in the world. We don't put anything over these titles, Arn says. Not even women. To which Tully says, what? And Arn continues his promo. Meanwhile, Tully is leaning back behind Arn, communicating with JJ via hand signals and whatnot. Arn makes his point. They're going to work through everything. They've done too much to win the tag titles, to lose them now or whatever. He finishes, and Tully stops him and clarifies. Listen, I know what Arn got a little carried away. We do care about women when we are having our victory parties. And Arn said, well, I was only talking about business hours.
They're so great.
I love the Horsemen.
They're amazing.
They're perfect. This is the best act ever. Ivan Koloff versus Mike Jackson.
God, this could have been a great match.
This could have been so good.
A minute.
Ivan won with a second rope sickle in a minute. If you're going to have Ivan do a squash, there's 100 other guys you could have used than Mike Jackson.
Paul Jones is out there going nuts about Starrcade. He's got the ball bearing. Ivan Koloff, the warlord. Plus, he says, the mighty Wilbur is coming. I think he's there next week.
I can't wait.
Oh, I cannot wait. There's another promo. Go
Mike
ahead, Tom.
Jackson looked like every guy on the British World of Sport rerun.
He actually did, didn't he? That's yeah. true.
I believe he looks exactly like that today as he still wrestles and has good matches.
Oh, yeah. He was in the opener at All-Star Wrestling, right?
Oh, my God.
Is that him?
Dude, oh. May as well have been.
Tom, Breaker, this is your first time.
Breaker Joe? Is that,
oh, no. That was not Mike Jackson.
What was his name?
It was Breaker Joe, and it was Breaker, and it was just a...
Eton or something?
Yeah, like random letters that are not a name.
Yeah.
That guy was cool, too. He was no Mike Jackson. So, Tom, this is your first time ever seeing number one Paul Jones.
Yeah, what do you think of Paul Jones' promo?
The first one was brutal.
About how the mighty Wilbur's right around the corner?
Oh, my God. The second one wasn't as bad.
There he said, two of them, right? Lots of people are making names for themselves. He says he's never let anyone down in his army. Promises them one thing, and then gives them more. He has promised the mighty Wilbur every title in the NWA.
Oh, my goodness.
And he says, before I will sleep at night, you'll see my army conquer everyone. And I'm like, so you've never slept again? And he's got that fucking writing crop that he's whacking on the table repeatedly as he's talking. I still love him.
I love Skandar Akbar.
The Canadian Kodiaks debuted and maybe exited at the same time.
Listen, when I heard the Canadian Kodiaks, I was like, the Canadian Kodiaks? Then I see them, I'm like, total Road Warrior clones. Then they announce that their names are Hog and Bear.
Yes. Like,
are you fucking kidding
like
me?
Like, if you're making a wrestling video game and you wanted the Road Warriors in the game, but you didn't want to pay a licensing fee, you would call them Hog and Bear.
And Bear? I just about died.
So they're two big... They're like...
Keep in mind, they're the Canadian Kodiaks. They're both supposed to be bears. One of them's a hog? This doesn't even make any sense.
That's also true. That's also true. So they've been plugging these guys the whole show. They come out here to face Rocky King
Couldn't
and
be
Terry
Polar
Jones.
And Grizzly, for example. Even though those are also not Kodiaks.
They misspelled Kodiak. That's another thing.
I didn't catch that. They
it's with
want,
a K at the end, right?
It should be K-O-D-I-A-K.
Yes.
They have
yeah,
the
that's
C?
Not how they spelled it. Yeah.
Maybe their last name is Kodiak. Hog Kodiak and Bear Kodiak. From Canada.
We have
Tony claimed the match took not even a second. Not
that's right.
Even
it was
a
close.
Second. It took a second. Wait, not even a second. He had to clarify.
I wrote they won in like 10 seconds. They tried some double-team backbreaker and botched it.
Oh, yeah, they couldn't even get Rocky King up.
Yeah.
The smallest jobber on the roster.
So they go to the promo desk where Akbar cuts a promo, and let's look at the Canadian Kodiaks, and they're simultaneously, like, the two biggest, most jacked-up guys you ever saw, and also the most generic guys you ever saw. It's like if High Voltage were bigger but even more plain. It's kind of amazing.
What was, like, a fat Brock Lesnar, kind
of? A little bit. There's a little bit of that.
It's like a fat Lesnar and a fat animal. Hog and Bear.
The other one was like Heidenreich.
Could have been, yeah.
So Akbar cuts his promo that it could have been any heel promo of the past 40 years, just plugging the names Hog, Bear, and Canadian Kodiaks. And yes, he kept calling them also the Lords of Discipline. I think this whole thing was a desperate attempt, like on his part alone. To try and
I'm pretty sure he was shooting his own angle.
He's trying to change it.
He's going to business for himself, desperately trying to bait the Road Warriors into a feud.
I'm 90% positive that's what happened.
So
I'm sorry, the handshake that they did behind his head.
No,
I didn't.
They tried to do like they were gonna shake hands like brothers, you know, like fists up. But one of them didn't go to shake hands. One of them went and grabbed the other one's wrist. And he like held it up and shook it.
This act.
The Canadian Kodiak.
I hope you enjoyed
Tom.
It while you can.
It was so awkward.
I've never heard of these men. I looked them up. Apparently, they had been doing some shows for the UWF, which is where they came from with Akbar. And they came to Crockett, and their paycheck sunk, and they quit.
Yeah.
And they got out of the business and did whatever else with their lives.
I can only imagine.
Like, the big guys in the background looking around up into the sky, opening their mouths, letting their head move like they're a movie monster. Warlord was doing the same thing.
Oh, God.
Like, hold on.
Kevin Sullivan versus George South. Kevin beat him and beat him and beat him. South was bleeding from the forehead, I believe from the chest as well. And Sullivan won with the rib crusher.
Okay, seriously here. We've been watching this for a while. Is Kevin Sullivan a babyface? I keep asking this. He must be, right? He's out there cutting a promo for Dusty Rhodes.
He wrestles a straight heel match, cuts a straight babyface promo, runs down all the heels, talks about how great Dusty is. By the end of this, I think...
He had to be a babyface.
I think he's trying to set a trap for Dusty. To earn Dusty's respect and
his
trust.
That would make sense.
And then stab him in the back.
Okay, because he
spends half this promo talking about how great Dusty Rhodes is. And the last thing he says, now granted, trying to translate Kevin Sullivan into English is always a dangerous proposition, but he says, "Don't lock up your chickens before you look inside, because there may be a cobra in your own chicken house."
Mm. Deep.
I don't know if the Briscoes have to worry about cobras in the chicken house. They would be the ones I would ask, but yeah. Now,
George South also seen recently sleeping at PWG next to Big Dave.
Really?
Well,
that wasn't George South.
Okay, which was worse for Ronnie Garvin, the promo or this match?
Oh, the promo by far.
I kind of like this match.
This was just a match where he tied the guy in knots, stomped the shit out of him, gave him a Garvin stomp, which was a great Garvin stomp.
I guess.
And then pinned him.
I just watched this thinking, at no point did I think you are the best wrestler in the
world. No, of course not.
Nor are you the biggest star in the world.
No, but I thought that a lot less when I saw that stupid promo. It's fun beating a guy up.
He's done better beatings.
Well, sure, but I mean, this wasn't any worse than any of those other beatings.
The announcers even at one point said, and you know what was great about him is, nothing has changed. And I was like, something should have changed. Because he was merely Ronnie Garvin before, and he is now still merely Ronnie Garvin.
Yeah.
Some guys get the belt and it changes them and they get better right away, and some don't. He did, in fact, win with the Garvin stomp.
Did he?
Yeah.
I thought he just kept stomping him with his one foot.
Yeah, he did. That's the Garvin stomp. Then he sat on him.
That is the Garvin stomp. When you stomp on his... That's the move.
Excuse me?
You stomp on his...
That's his finisher?
You stomp on his face,
well,
then his arm, then his belly, then his leg, then his other leg.
The finish...
That's his finisher?
He has just debuted the Garvin stomp. His finish used to be...
Excuse me?
He would punch them in the face.
The Garvin stomp was an upgrade.
I'll give you the history, Tom. For 2 years, he would punch people in the head, and that was his finish. He would just punch them. And then one day in the middle of the match,
well,
he said...
Big Show does that, so...
One day in the middle of the match, he looks over, and he says, David... I got a new move. Watch. And he did the Garvin stomp and then sat on the guy. And now that's his finish. One of them.
Huh.
Yeah, he did pin the guy. That was it.
And it also ties in nicely with the top rope sunset flip.
Of course. One is a setup for the other. Sheep Herders versus Keith Steinborn and Ed Franks. Sheep Herders are still awesome.
Oh my God, they're the best. Yeah, Johnny Ace, I'm baffled by him.
So we'll get to Johnny Ace shortly. I don't even know what to say. But all the Sheepherders do, they clubber dudes, and they stomp them, and they elbow them, and they choke them. But they do it with great energy.
They just beat the shit out of them. Like, nonstop action. Tag,
yes.
tag, beat, 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 tag, battering ram, double gut buster, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Then they cut the best promo since the heyday of Ric Flair. Second best promo on the show here.
Yep.
Just out of their minds.
So, Butch is the one who does the talking. Most of the talking.
Yes.
Luke basically just repeats things that Butch says.
Yes.
Or occasionally shouts out random names.
Yes.
But he's awesome at it.
Yes.
He's fantastic at it. They both kind of squint one eye like Popeye. Both missing teeth. Just fabulously ugly. Johnny Ace, 8 feet tall behind them with a 7-foot mullet.
Yeah.
And the sunglasses and a mustache. occasionally just looking around randomly like he's bored or he forgot where he's supposed to be. They run down every team in the world. They vow to win the tag team titles, and in the process, they're going to beat up every team in the world. And their catchphrase is one guy goes, "Oh!" And the other guy goes, "Yeah!" And that's it.
I love them.
They're fantastic.
They're the best thing on the show besides Flair and the Horsemen.
I don't think the other guy's got any offense, right? This is
100%
squash.
Right? It was awesome.
Not even when they tagged out, it was the Sheepherders taking the guy to the corner to tag the other man in and then punching him as soon as he walked in the ring.
And, you know, even though they're very similar, like, they're so great because of their differences. When you watch that promo, you see, what is it, Luke, looking up into the sky.
Yes.
His lack of teeth are showing. Yes. One eye seems to be going glassy. But he's just perfect playing off of Butch. I wish these guys were around today.
Oh, man, it'd be the best.
They gotta be.
Maybe they can come back for the Raw 25th anniversary show. All of them. The whole act.
This version of Johnny Ace. You ever watch Curb Your Enthusiasm?
No. Kidding me?
Johnny Ace reminds me of Super Dave Osborne.
I know Super Dave Osborne.
Well, his voice is very similar.
Okay, they do have similar voices. I was going to say Super Dave has so much more talent and charisma than Johnny Ace. He's a much better performer. Warlord versus Mac McGiver.
Disappointing.
Warlord, big Seth Petruzzelli fan.
Really?
Yeah. He was a bodyguard for Kimbo.
Oh.
Actually. And it was the day before Seth ended up taking that fight. Warlord had told him how big of a fan he was. And after the fight, I remember he came back and congratulated Seth. Or, like, you know, gave him, like, a good job, you know, like a way to go.
I picture Warlord when he wants to congratulate someone, he just flexes his bicep at them.
It may have been a twitch.
Yeah. So he comes out here.
He twitched and his fist went up.
We watched Warlord. He debuted for like two matches a year ago and was like the worst wrestler you ever saw. Now he has improved to the point where he is just bad and boring. The finish is a power slam and he goes to pick Mac McGiver up. And usually when you're doing this move, you know, you got one arm in it's a crotch lift. You have one arm in his crotch. The other hand is on like his shoulder or his neck holding you up. Warlord has the other hand on his face. He's lifting up by the face as Mac McGiver whimpers loudly because his face is being covered. And then Warlord slammed him down and pinned him.
Mac McGiver. Then another Paul Jones promo.
He did.
Warlord has a body women love and men fear. He's whacking the desk with his writing crop. Dares anyone with the guts to sign a contract to get in the ring with any of his men. They have open contracts. You can't say, he says, that I'm running or hiding in the closet. What? Then he explains why he's a great manager. He goes, I have an incentive program for my performers. If they do well, I pay them more.
This makes them happy.
I'm like, what in the fuck is going on here? What are you talking about?
He had a lot to say about hanging the moon.
Just get the damn Wilbur here already.
You had three or four different references.
Who is this guy? I gotta look up this
guy. Oh, just watch next week, Tom.
Hell no.
Come on. Stick with us.
This show did nothing to coerce me to watch. I would get more joy and excitement out of listening to the review.
Oh,
this was not an especially good episode of this show. Except for Flair.
Yeah, the garbage. You're telling me your world champion is winning with a stomp?
Yes.
A series of stomps.
And Mighty Wilbur, this is Mighty Wilbur? Are you kidding me?
You haven't seen him yet.
Oh, I'm looking online right now.
Oh, you spoiled it.
Well, granted, he's like Braun Strowman.
Kind of is like Braun Strowman, but
yeah,
different.
Wilburier.
Yeah.
Terry Taylor versus Tommy Angel. So as you know,
fucking guy comes out and says, I'm going to put both belts up on the line right now.
Eddie is holding up both TV belts right there and says, we will defend both of these right now.
Yeah, and they somehow already have graphics announcing this. I'm like, so the fucking graphics guy is okay with this?
No,
but like,
it just said UWF TV champ.
No, it said for both. The NWA and the UWF. It said both on the screen. I watched it right there. It's
so
stupid.
Tommy Angel needs bigger trunks. I'm seeing too much of his ass. Terry punched him a lot, hit a flying forearm and figure four for the win. The only notable thing here was, at one point, Taylor throws him outside, and he screams, hey, this guy's trying to steal Terry's belt, and puts the boots to him.
Yes.
That was funny.
That was funny. Taylor, a very low-level Ric Flair, decent worker, No Ric Flair. Nowhere near the charisma. I was not entertained. But then the real horsemen came back.
The real horsemen came back, all four of them. Flair admits, you know, I may have lost my composure earlier. You don't fucking say.
Last week he had the line about not being the only rooster in the hen house, not producing eggs.
Yeah.
He pulls out the same line, except he changed it this week. He says, everybody has a belt here except me. I will not be the only rooster on the farm not causing the hens to lay eggs, because eggs bring home the bacon.
That's what he said.
What? One guy could pull off that line. It's Ric Flair.
Yes, he says, the great thing about the horsemen is that, yes, they may fall down, but when you fall down, all the other horsemen are there to rally you, and they're rally together, and the recovery time is very short. He said all three of these men are studs because they all have belts, and he had his line about not being the only rooster who was not making hens lay eggs. Luger talks for a while, says he still calls Flair champ because he knows it's only a matter of time until Flair gets that belt back again. And they all started screaming they were all champs, and Ronnie Garvin's on borrowed time, and they did a group handshake, and that was that. The horsemen were so great.
They always are.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Nothing else really that you wouldn't miss in the show.
Well, Tom, what'd you think?
Sucked.
Well, let's get funky like a monkey.
Anyway, let's talk about this NWA show. That's it. That's all tonight, everybody. The NWA show. I don't want to hear any complaints. We're doing a show on New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
This is what you get.
National Wrestling Alliance World Championship Wrestling, October 17th, 1987. Show opened with clips of an in-ring angle, which I don't even want to talk about because it's awesome.
Just save it.
We'll save it till we get to it.
God, people talk about how great the Chris Jericho, Kenny Omega angle was sending up the Tokyo Dome. You ain't seen nothing. Jericho would watch this and go, you know what? They got me.
He'd cancel the match.
I don't know if he'd cancel the match, but he'd certainly wish he could do his angle again.
Yes. The announcers promised today would be the debut of the Mighty Wilbur.
Yes.
Speaking of debuts, Gladiator number one versus Sting.
Yeah, he's just there.
Sting no is music, just... not even an entrance. He's just in the ring.
No.
Big jacked up dude with face paint and big spiky hair and a rat tail.
In the opener. They're like, hey, it's Sting. And all of a sudden, sure as shit, there's Sting.
God bless Sting. Great star. Looked so horrible here.
Well, he was green.
He looked
clunky.
First match awkward.
Yeah, but you know what? He worked a basic match.
Yeah.
He was obviously very athletic.
Yes.
He was nowhere near the worst guy I've ever seen on this show.
Oh,
not even close.
No.
He was fine.
I wouldn't say that. When he whipped the guy in for the back elbow and was lifting the elbow before the Irish whip was even done.
Well, you know, he hit it.
All of this said.
So he was successful with that back elbow.
All of this said, he hit the Stinger Splash and won. He looked great. His look was great, and charisma unseen on the show in ring as far as in ring charisma goes, and people loved him from the get go.
They were super into this guy.
As horrible as his work was, they loved him. And he hits a Stinger Splash and he wins. And he goes to get his promo. He's always talking about how it's great to be here on WTBS for the first time. Starcade's coming up. He can't wait to make a big impression at Starcade. And Tony says, "Well, good to hear. Best of luck." He puts the mic back and Sting goes, ow! And everyone loved him. A star was born.
What he actually said was Starcade was going to be a big night for him. And he says, my red blood cells get going and I just go crazy.
That's what he said.
And there's a pause. And Tony's just like, cool. And that was it. He did a shriek and he left. His red blood cells are getting going?
That's what he said.
What's he talking about?
You take it up with him. I'm not going to argue with Sting. Sheep Herders versus David Isley and John Savage.
I know I've mentioned this before, but the Sheep Herders are my favorite new act in this company.
They are
in forever.
So great at squash matches because they get their energy up to 100% and just stays there. They do not take a moment off.
No, listen, a lot of these squash matches are... You know, guys just, they do some holds, and they do some moves, and then they win. Sheepherders go in there, and they beat the shit out of guys.
Mm-hmm.
They crush them. These are crush matches, not squash matches. They crush them.
They
could not have been a bigger waste in WWF.
No, that's it's hard to realize they're the same men. They were on offense 100% of the time. They gave the guys no offense, and if they had, they wouldn't have sold it.
And it's good tag team work. They constantly tag in and out.
Yes.
They never get tired because they never give themselves the opportunity to get tired.
They do not go through the motions.
No.
They go out there, and they work. And they won with the battering ram and the gut buster. Then they go to cut a promo, and they just yank the mic away from David Crockett and do it all on their own. And you got Johnny Ace behind them, who has the
he is completely useless. Why is he here? Vinny, if you took him out, does it hurt the act in any way? No.
I would notice his absence. Something about having this big stiff with the mullet and the mustache and the glasses who just stands there. He just holds the flag. He's their flag bearer. He has one job, and that's it. And there's this big, mute goof behind them, and you've got one lunatic who just nods and says, yeah, and another lunatic ranting and raving, and he provides a contrast to that.
It's unneeded.
I
Vinny, you take him out of there, they're as awesome as they were with him there. He adds nothing.
I can't say he adds nothing.
He adds nothing, dude.
He adds something.
No. One of these days he's not going to be there. I guarantee you won't notice.
Oh, we'll see.
You'll be sitting there going, God damn, the sheep herders are the best.
Regardless, the sheep herders are the best. And they're ranting and raving about annihilating is the process of elimination. That means annihilation and elimination, the getting rid of all the teams between themselves and the tag titles. And Starcase coming up, and they want the Lightning Express. Tim Horner and Brad Armstrong.
Oh, God. Please, give them to them. Drag a good-ass match out of them.
I love the Sheepherders.
They're boring asses. God bless them.
Starcade Update. That's what it was called. It was...
Now, let me begin.
Okay.
Jim Crockett's there. Tony Schiavone's there. And Ron Garvin is there. And Jim Crockett, in his boring-ass monotone manner, says... There is a huge announcement that we've been working on for a week. For a week?
Sure.
Of course, the big announcement is Ronnie Garvin versus Ric Flair in a no DQ cage match. The fucking main event.
Yeah.
They've been working on that, Vinny, for a damn week. Whew. Man, oh man.
Thank God it's done.
A week? Could they have made it seem any less special the way... And then fucking Ronnie doesn't help.
I was going to say.
You know, people... They always bring up Ron Garvin's first promo after he won the belt. Okay? Everybody, get over that. That ain't the problem. The problem is every promo afterwards. If he would have come out the day after he won the title and cut a Ric Flair prime promo, but then followed it up with all of this shit, he still would have been an utter failure. These promos get worse every single time. The promo he cut when he won the title was, to this point in the show, the best Ronnie Garvin promo we'd seen so far. They're only getting worse. Thankfully, he saved it later in the show. But this was atrocious.
He says, you know, being world champion is better than getting married or having kids or winning $1 million.
Wrong.
He just moves on. He loses his train of thought. Then starts to ramble about Flair for a while. And finally says Flair's getting the rematch he's due. This was terrible. This was not live. And it's one of those where I can't believe nobody said, cut! We're doing that one again.
Listen, I'm a wrestling fan, love wrestling. When I was a little kid, I dreamed of being the world champion. I'll take my baby and $1 million over being the world champion. I'm telling you, what was the third one he said?
The wife.
Oh, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Give me all three of those before the world title.
I highly recommend you add her in there.
Jiminy Christmas. What do you think I am?
Let's see. Crockett added that Garvin would not defend the title until Starcade to ensure that match took place as signed. And they moved on to the TV title match. So the entire whole angle where the NWA TV belt got stolen.
Boy, he had a lot of faith in Ron Garvin, by the way. Just to make sure that this match takes place, you're not allowed to defend the title, dude.
No.
You very easily could fail.
Anyone could beat you. It showed the entire brawl between Terry Taylor and Nikita Koloff. I forgot how terrible it was. It was a terrible brawl. And then they announced there'll be a TV title unification match at Starcade. And Crockett was confident the NWA TV champ would come out on top. Barry Windham comes out for a promo.
You know, Tony, when he announced the unification match, Tony starts, for the first time ever in professional wrestling history. And I'm like, Tony, don't do this. Why must you lie? But then he mentioned, a TV title unification match. And I was like, he may be right. This is the TV title. He didn't just say the first unification match. He specifically said TV title unification match between two major companies. He may have been correct.
So Barry Windham comes out for a promo to, A, hype up his Western States Championship defenses against Arn Anderson, and more importantly, his UWF title match challenging Steve Williams at Starrcade. He said he liked Arn, or he didn't like Arn, but he liked Steve, and they would have a good fight.
Boy, that makes me want to see that match.
Yeah.
Nothing I like better than, I like this guy. We're going to have a wrestling match for a championship.
Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson versus Rocky King and George South.
You know, George South is a pretty good jobber.
Mm-hmm.
But boy, did he... I don't know if it was by design. He looked so jobberish this afternoon. He was a little fatter, a little whiter. His hair was a little more unkempt. He was in there to do a job to these guys.
They actually gave him more offense than they usually do. They quickly won with a spine buster and a slingshot suplex. Then hit a gourd buster afterwards for good measure. They would be back later and make a much better impression. Terry Taylor versus Larry Stevens.
You know, it doesn't seem fair that Terry Taylor's title is on the line before Starrcade and Ron Garvin's is not.
You would have to take this up with Jim Crockett.
Actually, I think it would be... Would it be Jim Crockett or would it be the football player?
It would be John Ayers, actually. John Ayers, UWF title. That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
he has faith in his men.
He does. Well, to be fair, it was Larry Stevens.
That doesn't matter, Vinny. Ron Garvin beat Ric Flair. What are we talking about here?
I don't know. Larry Stevens is out there in purple trunks with five random pink stripes down the back. And I mean random. They're just in random places down his ass. Taylor has left me very underwhelmed in this whole run he's had here as TV champion. But I thought this is his most aggressive and his most effective performance yet. He hit a knee drop in particular. Looked like he killed the guy. 1 and 2 minutes with a figure four. Then Gilbert cut a promo about how it's time to take the old horse out back and shoot it, and Taylor was going to do just that to Nikita at Starrcade.
Well, we still have the issue that Gilbert is the better talker and worker, and he's hanging out there as a manager.
I don't know what to tell you about that, man.
Come on.
It's just a fact. It's what they're doing. It's what they're doing. Okay. Best thing on the show, and there were some good things on the show. We haven't gotten to them yet. We're at a house show. Outcome J.J. Dillon and the Shogun, Hiro Matsuda.
All right, let me talk about this entrance, then you can continue. This is the most stereotypical thing you've ever seen. Hiro Matsuda is, as they claim, from the Orient. He's going to demonstrate the Oriental version of the sleeper hold.
That's right.
So he's coming down to the ring with J.J. Dillon. The arena has been darkened. It is a darkened building. They're coming out, and they're playing what is, I guess, traditional Japanese music.
Stereotypical is a good word.
Or as they would call it in 86, Oriental music.
Yeah.
They're coming down to the ring. Hiro Matsuda is wearing a karate gi with kanji, or whatever you call it, on the back.
Yeah.
A black belt, but also slacks and dress shoes.
Sure.
What? Why is he wearing slacks and dress shoes?
He probably showed up in a suit. And they said, we need you to be the Shogun of the Orient tonight. Put on this gi.
Dude. They call him the Shogun himself. Mm-hmm. Hiro Matsuda, here to demonstrate the Oriental version of the sleeper hold.
Yep. Now,
one other thing, by the way. Mm-hmm. He was 50 years old here.
Yeah.
He looked great.
Absolutely.
Sadly, he got prostate cancer and was dead 12 years later.
That sucks.
But man, I couldn't believe it. I was Googling to see how old he was, and I thought, man, oh man, that guy looks great for 50.
So, he demonstrated the Oriental Sleeper on Tommy Young, the referee.
They said he was going to demonstrate to Tommy Young so Tommy Young could understand the intricacies.
Yeah, because
and then Tommy could show it to the other referees.
Because they claim the Weaver Lock is an illegal hold.
Yes.
So they want to show him a legal sleeper so he understand the differences. So he grabs Young from behind and chokes him out in 3 seconds. And Tommy's drooling. He releases the hold and Tommy begins to go into convulsions on the mat.
And Matsuda does not wake him up.
No. So a panicked Johnny Weaver hits running into the ring.
Now, here's the best part about him running in. The announcers say Johnny Weaver must have seen something. It's like maybe the convulsions. That could possibly be what he saw, right?
I don't know. So Johnny wakes up Tommy Young to save his life.
Slaps him on the back of the neck.
That's right. That's how you wake a guy up after you put him out with a sleeper.
For real, everybody, that's not how you wake somebody up if you put your buddy out with a sleeper. Like, lift their legs up in the air. Don't whack him in the back of the fucking neck when they're unconscious.
So Dylan starts barking and yelling at Weaver. And Weaver stands up, and he looks at him, and he hits the best punch you ever saw in your entire life.
I think he slapped him.
It may have been a slap.
I thought it was a slap. Like, you're such an asshole, and he slaps him.
He looks at him, and it's lightning quick, and he goes from... The first time I saw it, I thought he just fired out straight from the hip. And when I watched it a second time, he did do a little bit of a windup. He did rear back a little bit, and his hand shot out, and he hit Dylan in the face. It may have been a slap, because Dylan just holds his face and his jaw, and he's more shocked than stunned. So maybe it was a slap. So this is already the best thing I ever saw, just based on this punch.
And by the way, J.J. Dylan, I mean... So in storyline, Hiro Matsuda put out this referee... And then wasn't going to wake him up. He was going to abandon him and potentially leave him to die.
Yeah.
Johnny Weaver has to save the referee's life. JJ's just howling at all of this. And Johnny Weaver slaps him. And JJ just can't believe the temerity of Johnny Weaver. How dare you slap me?
How do you lay hands on the manager of the Four Horsemen?
Dare you?
So Weaver considers his job done here. He has saved a man's life. He's taught a rapscallion a lesson. But then he turns and realizes he is now alone in the ring with the Shogun. And his eyes bug out, and he goes deer in the headlights.
Well, he turned around a little too early, and Hiro Matsuda was a little too far away.
But it made it all better.
And so he knew what was coming, but he just had to wait. And so it was, in fact, like on SmackDown, for those of you that watch SmackDown, when they did the deal with Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon on Thursday, and they had the awkward stare at each other for 9 full fucking seconds. I'm not making this up. 9 seconds they stood and stared at each other.
It's a long time.
This was not that long.
This was, but it
felt like an eternity.
This was maybe 2.5 seconds in all seriousness.
I think it was maybe 1 second.
But that's a long time to turn there and wait for a guy to hit you.
Especially
with your eyes bugging out. So he freezes. And eventually Matsuda approaches. And what does Matsuda do?
Well,
he elbow the man?
I Googled it.
Okay.
I believe it was a double liver thrust.
He does not hit him in the face. He does not throw an elbow or a knee or a kick. He rears back with both hands and thrusts them both into Johnny Weaver's abdomen.
Yes. If you imagine how Meng used to do the Tongan death grip, where he would stand there and he would do some sort of kata and then thrust one hand at the man's neck, Matsuda did this with two hands to the man's liver.
Yes.
This incapacitated Weaver.
It did incapacitate him, which made it easy pickings for the Shogun to then put on the Oriental Sleeper. And Johnny Weaver's eyes roll back in his head. Blood begins to seep out of his mouth. He's being killed.
Fucking David Crockett is losing his shit in the booth.
And Dusty Rhodes and Barry Windham and Ronnie Garvin all run out and make the save. They do not slap Weaver on the back of his neck, but they do somehow revive him and make sure he's alive. And Dylan begins to shout and scream about how Dusty Rhodes has to face Hiro Matsuda in the ring. He's not even going to make it to Starrcade. And Dusty and Matsuda have a stare down, and Dusty tears off his shirt, and he's all fat everywhere.
But he's serious.
And Dylan pulls Matsuda away before things get physical. This was so fucking awesome.
This was the angle of a generation.
It was amazing. Why is this not more famous?
I have absolutely no idea.
With the possible exception of Dusty and Matsuda may have done the same thing 50 times. That's possible.
This was so fucking incredible. And you know what? I want you to guys, listen. I don't like to just always make comparisons and bury WWE. They've done some good things, WWE has, since 1963, you know, 5 or 6. Think about all the guys that have debuted from NXT.
Okay?
This is not a debut from NXT, but when's the last time we saw Hiro Matsuda on NWA World Championship Wrestling television?
It's been years.
Not since we started watching.
Yeah.
So this was basically his debut.
Sure.
He's a fucking main eventer against Dusty Rhodes in a match where you fear he may kill fucking Dusty Rhodes.
End of the life of the American Dream.
They did this with one angle.
Yeah.
Which was so fucking simple.
Mm-hmm.
This was very much like Chris Jericho and Kenny Omega. The angle that they did where Jericho just shows up behind the guy and beats the shit out of him and Omega juices, and now it's like the biggest angle, the biggest match potentially at the entire fucking Tokyo Dome show. That's what this was. Meanwhile, how many guys have they called up and they've just meant nothing?
All of them.
One fucking simple angle. With Hiro Matsuda choking out a goddamn referee.
And an old guy.
And an old guy!
Yes.
This was unbelievable. Unbelievable.
When Vader beat up Gorilla Monsoon, was that his debut in the company?
No, that was like much later.
Okay. That's the only thing I think of that might be close that WWE has ever done.
God, it was awesome.
I'm sure there's others people will think of, but anyway. So then they go back to the studio, where J.J. Dillon is there with Lex Luger, who I believe was wearing a members-only jacket. And Lex says, Jim Crockett is putting on the biggest show of all time, Starrcade. He knows I need to be in the show. And that means he will agree to any stipulations that I want. So Dusty Rhodes, if you're going to get a match with me, you're going to have to go through all my stipulations, and it's going to be the match I want. And then Dillon is sure to add, assuming, of course, that Dusty survives his match against Hiro Matsuda first.
I apologize, by the way. It was not his debut. He debuted in the Royal Rumble, but he did destroy Monsoon the next night.
Okay, that's close then.
So there you go.
That's the closest we can think of. Paul Jones came out for a promo, but before he can speak, they show video of the Mighty Wilbur's debut.
This was also incredible. I know you're stunned.
The show turned around really here, these last two angles, or two segments.
And you know why it was great?
Many reasons, actually.
Well, the main reason it was great?
Paul Jones.
How Paul Jones sold all of this. Without Paul Jones, this does not work.
Oh, no.
No. Well, you begin, and then I'm going to explain why Paul Jones was so great.
So they're at a house show somewhere. Out comes number one Paul Jones, as usual, with the mariachi-esque gear and the riding crop, angry and hating everyone. And out comes Mighty Wilbur. Big hillbilly dude in coveralls.
A good old country boy.
Got two bandanas around his neck, red and blue. And he's got a beard, which is an unusual thing in 1987, as opposed to 2017 when everybody has one. And he comes out, and he is shaking hands with every single fan he can touch. And this makes Paul Jones irate. And he runs up and whacks him with a riding crop and says, "Stop shaking these damn hands again in the ring." And Wilbur just laughs and keeps on shaking hands with everyone. Paul Jones gets more and more pissed. Finally, Wilbur gets in the ring, and Jones is unloading on him with a riding crop. Wilbur's completely no-selling it, maybe even laughing it off. And he shakes hands with the ref, and he shakes hands with his opponent, Ricky Nelson. They do a match. It's very short. He slams Nelson a few times. He wins with a splash. Jones hits the ring, orders Wilbur to attack more. Wilbur just laughs and smiles, won't have anything to do with this. So Johnny Weaver's there to interview them. Jones says, "Listen, Mighty Wilbur, I paid a lot of money for you. You're going to do what I tell you." And like every word, he's punctuating with a riding crop to the face of the chest. And Wilbur just keeps on laughing it off. And Jones says, "You will never shake hands with these snot-nosed kids." And Weaver says, "Wilbur, what do you have to say about that?" And Wilbur just laughs and giggles and says, "The old puddin' head's a little upset." Paul Jones, in the greatest thing I've ever seen Paul Jones do for about 20 minutes, has an epic meltdown. Don't you ever call me Puddinhead. And he's whacking him with a stick. It's phenomenal. And he leads Wilbur away.
The reason Paul Jones is so great is because if you take Paul Jones out of this, or you put anybody else in, okay, why is Paul Jones mad? Because, granted, he obviously likes heels. He wants the man to be a bad guy. He doesn't like the people. But he has hired Mighty Wilbur sight unseen. and Wilbur came in and just destroyed this guy.
Mm-hmm.
He looked like an unstoppable monster.
Right.
This should be enough for Paul Jones.
Yeah.
But it's not.
No, he didn't do it the right way.
That's right. Logically, he shouldn't be mad. So him getting so upset about this, the way he sold it, the fans are in hysterics. They are so happy to see Paul Jones so infuriated. Not to mention Puddinhead. Paul Jones cannot handle being called Puddinhead. Why? It doesn't make any sense, okay? But Paul, no, that's my whole point. None of this makes any sense, but Paul made it work.
It makes sense to him.
He's the only one. But he did such a great job convincing you that he cared, that you were so happy to see him so infuriated.
And they go back to the studio where Jones rants and raves a bit, and he promises, Mighty Wilbur is 6'4" and 450 pounds, and I'm going to make him the most vicious man in the world.
And you're going to see a changed man tonight.
Storms off.
And you knew what that was going to lead to. And there was no swerve.
No, absolutely not. It was the anti-swerve. They made a promise and they delivered. Kevin Sullivan versus Tony Suber. Sullivan chopped the hell out of him a few times, took him down. Then he won with a move that was like part hammerlock, part half Nelson, or maybe a Rings of Saturn.
Might have been the sugar hold.
I'm not sure. He won quickly. And then he got a promo, and this, I don't know. Sullivan eventually is a heel. Spoiler alert, everyone. Sullivan's a very hated man in 1988.
I thought it was very clear here that he's a heel.
Yeah.
Like, it was questionable for a few weeks there.
Yeah.
He was absolutely positively a heel.
He talks about how all the baby faces are going to win at Starrcade. Road Warriors are going to win. Rock and Roll Express is going to beat up Jim Cornette. He did say Ric Flair would beat Ronnie Garvin, but that's hardly, you know, that's very credible. Then he moves on to Dusty Rhodes. Nobody knows Asia better than me, Kevin Sullivan says.
Nobody knows more about Asia than I do. I've been there.
Not even the Orient. Asia. The yes. Whole goddamn continent.
Hey, listen.
It's big.
He's a well-traveled evil man.
I guess so. He says he's been sitting in temples in Asia with Hiro Matsuda, and the temples had painting on the wall of a man holding another man's head. And then Sullivan said, to be the king, you have to kill the king. And you're in trouble, Dusty Rhodes.
He's in deep trouble.
Jimmy Valiant and Bugsy McGraw have complete go-away heat with me.
Oh, not Jimmy.
Maybe it's just Bugsy?
It's all Bugsy.
Fine.
Like, Jimmy was Jimmy, and Bugsy just comes across as a guy trying to be Jimmy, but he's not in any way.
I guess.
He's a try-hard. He's not very good. His promos suck. Now, listen, to be perfectly honest, okay, I don't get Bugsy McGraw, all right? Especially this babyface Bugsy McGraw. Maybe he was significantly better as a heel elsewhere, but, like, this guy sucks. Still, the fans are losing their shit. And they're not losing their shit for Jimmy. They're losing their shit for both of them. Bugsy's doing a stupid promo, and they're going crazy for this guy. So you know what? What do I know? More power to him.
Do you have any idea what they said in
Hell
the promo?
Hell no, okay. I have no idea.
All right, I'm done. Dusty came out for a promo. He calls Matsuda the master of evil, the master of the Orient, and the devil.
Sullivan's going to be pissed off.
I guess so. Then Dusty explains, I went to college to play football. I went to bars for education. And I went to Ladies of the Evening for insight.
Insight?
Well, then you spent too much money, Dusty Rhodes. He promised to take care of Matsuda and then the good-looking, college-educated Lex Luger. And that was that. Rock and Roll Express versus Robbie Idol and Eric Long.
What's with this new fake generic music?
New horrible network music for the Rock and Roll Express. They've been using different.
Yeah, this was different.
Yeah, it's worse.
Way worse.
I don't know why they had to edit in new network music, but they did. Morton still had his shoulder all taped up like it was in a sling. Didn't matter. They won quickly with a badly timed double DDT. Had the Dusty Rhodes entrance music video. Tully and Arn and JJ came out for a promo. And Tully and Arn had their match earlier, and they went back. They showered, they got all dressed up, and come out here looking all sharp. They say, we've got an open contract for Starrcade. Everyone's afraid to face us, because we're the best tag team in the world. And talking about Ricky Morton.
Well, yes. They said first, This is very important. We will take on any team, including the sheep herders.
They did say that.
I was like, well, can someone put that fucking match together like yesterday? I mean, come on.
They talk about how Ricky Morton was hurt when he had the title match, and that's true. But everyone's talking about that. Nobody's talking about how they were hurt going into their title match because they overcame their injuries and they won the tag team titles. Now these champions have dignity and class. And then they addressed, they didn't name him, but they talked about Terry Taylor taking shots at the NWA. So anyone coming in from an outside organization who wants to take shots at the NWA, sell out a few buildings first, then come talk to us. They stormed off.
You know, every time it's Hall of Fame season, we talk about different acts and that sort of thing, and there are a lot of criteria that go into your Hall of Fame voting. I mean, one of them, obviously, longevity. And, of course, a couple of years now, Tully and Arn are going to go to WWF, Brainbusters, flop. Tully's out of the business, whole nine yards. So, I mean, when you look at, like, the criteria and that sort of thing, I mean, maybe they shouldn't be in the Hall of Fame. But I fucking watch the show, and like every time they're on the screen, I'm like, they're Hall of Famers. I don't give a shit. Here's the thing. I don't give a shit about criteria when I watch them. Yeah. They're Hall of Famers. As a team, they were among the best teams in the entire world during that period.
Yeah.
Okay? As promos, less so Arn, even though Arn is like a great promo.
Arn is a very good promo. But Tully's, you know, a great promo.
Arn is the third best promo in this crew right here.
Oh, yeah.
J.J. Dillon and Tully Blanchard are fucking, not just world-class in the 80s, like world-class I ever saw.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? These fuckers are Hall of Famers.
You know what we need to do, you and me? We need to start, there already is a Hall of Fame, and that's fine, it can be there, we don't need to counter it, but we also need to start the Hall of Awesome. And here's the only here's the only criteria. Are you awesome?
Are you totally awesome?
And
These
fuckers are awesome, and they would be in there. Michael Hayes and Jimmy Garvin versus a miracle, Thunderfoot number one and Thunderfoot number two.
I couldn't figure out which was more bizarre. Hayes and Garvin teaming up on this show, mm-hmm. or the Thunderfoots together on the show.
Who have a gimmick. They're basically, for all intents and purposes, identical twins who never do anything together.
No, until but they did here.
They suck. It went a minute. Hayes won with a bulldog.
Maybe they sucked and they're like, well, we suck as a team. Let's just go our separate ways. And they sucked as singles. They're like, let's try this teaming thing again. They still fucking suck.
Maybe that's it.
That's why they never ended up in the Hall of Fame.
They are not in the Hall of Awesome.
No.
So Hayes and Garvin cut a promo. Michael Hayes says, to make a long story short, I have no friends because I keep stealing their women. Meanwhile, he's standing right next to his friend, Jimmy Garvin, and his woman, Precious.
Yep. Well, that was weird. You know.
So Garvin says he's got Starrcade fever. They'll wrestle anyone. He says, a lot of people said my brother Ronnie's greatest match was in September when he won that world title from Ric Flair. And he says, it was. Jimmy says, that's true, it was. But he's going to top that at Thanksgiving, that cage match at Starrcade.
Poor Ronnie. Letting everybody down, including his brother. And David standing there in awe of Michael Hayes.
Aren't we all?
In some ways, yeah.
In some ways. Yeah.
Not like I'm in awe of Tully or Rick.
That's true.
Or JJ.
But Jimmy Garvin and Michael Hayes, not that this is a surprise, but they are a fantastic combo.
Yes.
Ron Garvin versus Tommy Angel. Wasn't the Garvin style supposed to be a finisher?
That kind of was.
He hit it here and they just kept on wrestling.
I mean, everything he did to Tommy Angel was a finisher.
That's actually fair. He's got him laid out. Here's the finish. I'll just get to the finish. He's got him laid out. He goes to sit him up. But Angel can't even stay sitting up and just collapses back down. So Garvin sits him up again so he can punch him, then he pins him.
And as he is falling down the first time because he cannot even sit up on his own, some fan screams, he's playing possum.
That's
Ronnie!
Right. Yes. Well, he was not playing possum.
He was not playing possum.
He was on his last breath. So yes, the finish was punch to a seated man. Like a shining wizard, but a punch instead.
And then finally, Garvin cut a championship-level promo. I can't say world champion, but this was by far the best promo
He's
done as champion. Yeah. And maybe his best promo in quite a while, actually.
He had one great promo in the lead-up to the title match.
Sure.
But this is on his high on the list. And that being said, it wasn't that good. It was just much better than the others he's done.
Yes.
Yes. Flair then came out for a promo.
Well, we got to talk about what he said.
All right.
He said, I got Flair's number. Flair will not be winning the belt back. We were in a cage. The Horsemen could not get in. I won that match. And we're going to be in a cage again. Horsemen aren't going to get in. I'm going to win this match. Flair's been bragging for 5 years, but now he's merely a challenger, an ex-champion.
Yes.
And I'm going to walk into that cage as champion, and I'm going to walk out as the champion.
So now it's Flair's turn. Talks about Starrcade a little bit, just the rest of the card. Says his man Lex is going to beat Dusty Rhodes. He doesn't think the Road Warriors can hang with the Horsemen. He addresses Terry Taylor and Eddie Gilbert. Says, if you attack the NWA, you attack Ric Flair. And I am no fan of Nikita Koloff, but I hope he tears you apart. And there's not a man in the UWF who could beat me with one arm tied behind my back. Now as for Ronnie Garvin, hey, you're right, he says. There is no market for ex-world champions. I got women to answer to. I have bankers to answer to. I have marketing people to answer to. I'm living on the edge. And let me tell you something, Ronnie Garvin. You'll never see me in a bar telling a floozy or a geek.
Some floozy or some geek.
That he used to be world champion. I'm going to go out on a limb and guess that at many points in the past decades, he has been in bars of floozies and geeks telling them he's been world champion.
You kidding me? Every day.
Yes.
Every day, Ric Flair is surrounded by floozies and geeks. I promise you.
And he gleefully tells them all he was world champion. Anyway, he promised to make Garvin the shortest-lived world champion in history, which that opportunity had already passed. Then he started talking about how he was going to bring the championship to New York City. Go up and down Broadway and all this. And I'm thinking, isn't the title match in Chicago? Am I confused?
No. This was just, he's going to New York.
Okay.
And he just wants everyone to know he's on the prowl.
All right.
This has nothing to do with anything else, okay?
Okay.
He needs some floozies and some geeks. So, send that word.
Mighty Wilbur versus Italian Stallion.
You know who Mighty Wilbur is? He's Braun Strowman when he was a Rosebud.
Yeah.
Yep.
He's a big, scary guy who is not scary. He's nice and friendly. He thinks Paul Jones is just silly as Paul Jones is hitting him in the face with a riding crop. Wilbur just laughs it off. They did the exact same thing we saw earlier. He shakes hands with all the fans. He laughs as Paul Jones hits with the riding crop. He shakes hands with the referee. He shakes hands with the Stallion. Does a couple slams, hits a big splash and wins, then refuses to attack afterwards. So they bring out the Warlord and Ivan Koloff to beat this guy up. And then they go to do a promo, and Jones is upset again. He says, this is not your interview time. This is my interview time. You never speak unless I say so. And Wilbur just giggles and says, Jones is just getting upset again. Old Puddinhead. In 100,000 years, I cannot do justice to the meltdown Paul Jones had.
No one.
There's not a cartoon or a video game character or anything silly like that who's ever had a funnier noise come out of their mouth.
I was trying to think, who in history, if not Paul Jones, could have pulled this off? I can think of two names. Vince McMahon and Ric Flair. And nobody else.
Yosemite Sam. Like the closest
I'm talking wrestlers.
By the way, Hugh, I'm talking about characters of any kind, in any medium. It was spectacular.
He's practically weeping.
I wrote the same thing.
He's so infuriated to be called Puddin' Head.
He is
that
on the
sends
verge.
Him over the edge.
On the verge of tears.
Did something happen in Paul Jones' career where like he lost a pudding match or something like that and like this is coming back to haunt him here? Well, why is he so infuriated about this?
He lost a pudding eating contest somewhere along
Must
the way.
Must have been something.
He was beside himself as he orders Wilbur to the back. This was spectacular.
You know, if you listen to the best of 2017 or if you've listened to this show since 2005, there have been a lot of things that have happened in my life that have made me mad, whether it be Starbucks, Sparta's, Red Robin, whatever. Nothing has ever made me as mad as Paul Jones being called Puddinhead. Never.
No.
Not in the history of TNA. Not that barbed wire Christmas tree. Nothing has made me as angry as Paul Jones when Mighty Wilbur called him Puddinhead. And if you don't believe me, go back and watch it. This was worth the wait.
Oh, it was. It lived up to all expectations and all the hype. Midnight Express versus Mike Jackson and Rick Ryder.
I always thought that Midnight Express had Mike Jackson in their matches because they loved working with him. Didn't bother using him once here.
They did not tag him in one single time.
No.
And they beat up Rick Ryder for 2 minutes. They pinned him with the Gravedigger, which is a middle rope spine buster.
Sweet stand, by the way. Axe kick outside the ring. It was so horrible.
As you asked, why did he do that?
I had to watch it twice.
Yeah.
Like, normally, how can I explain this? So, normally, when you do an axe kick, it begins with an inside crescent.
Sure.
Your leg passes in front of you, and then up, and then down.
Yes.
He did an outside crescent. He just kind of went around the world and put his leg on back.
Usually you start, like, in front of the guy, and your leg comes up and then down over his head. Stan started the other end, so his leg had to travel over the guy's ass and all the way over his back.
Yeah, around his ass and then bonked him in the back.
It went way more horizontal than vertical.
And somehow he pulled it off. Like, it was fucking terrible, but only Sweet Stan could make this work.
He's fucking Sweet Stan.
He made it look sweet.
He did.
But I still thought it was stupid.
So,
and by the way, when they did that move, what'd they call it?
The Gravedigger?
The Gravedigger. Fucking, it was eaten. He has Rick Ryder, he's like hugging him. They do this move. Rick Ryder landed right on his fucking arm. This had to suck for both of them.
Yeah.
Probably more for Rick Ryder because he was expecting to land flat.
So the Cornette did a quick promo. I believe he made fun of Ricky Morton's sickly, cancer-stricken body. And that was that.
Yeah.
Stars of this show were the Mighty Wilbur, number one Paul Jones, and the Shogun, Hiro Matsuda.
This was a fun show.
It was, for those three reasons almost entirely.
By the way, if you've ever been to the chiropractor, like sometimes he'll lay you on the table and he'll put his like hand under your back or his fist.
Sure.
And then he'll just apply some pressure to your chest to adjust your spine. Eaton did this off the middle rope under Rick Ryder.
Yeah.
This could have been the end of his career. That was brutality. I love this show, everybody. Tell them the date again so they can go back and watch
October 17th, 1987.
Man, oh man.
You're gonna be mine all night long.
We'll make it into the Hall of Awesome.
That's how it works.
So why rush? Why rush through? These two men that are going into the Hall of Awesome today are undeniably awesome. That's why they're going in. All right, let's begin here.
World Championship Wrestling, October 24th, 1987. Show opened with clips of Paul Jones and the Mighty Wilbur. This love affair did not last long.
No. I thought it would go longer than it did.
More than a week?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, Wilbur's already lost patience, and Jones is giving him a browbeating and attacking him with a riding crop, and Wilbur just grabbed him, and I do mean grabbed him, and threw him into the ropes, and they freeze-framed to be continued. They promised we would learn the fate of old Puddinhead later in the show.
Like, he couldn't figure out what was going to happen when he threw him in and hit an elbow. Maybe, like, is he going to bump? Is he going to levitate?
Maybe Jones would duck and make a comeback.
Is Wilbur's elbow going to smash into shards?
Will Paul Jones' head fall clean off?
Yes.
They plugged the Nassau show, including War Games 4, which they did not specify who was in this, although later it was very clear Dusty Rhodes is one of them. Jimmy Valiant and Bugsy McGraw versus Tommy Angel and the worst wrestler of all time of the week, Eric Long.
This guy seriously was the new worst wrestler I think I've ever seen.
We have not done the worst wrestler of all time in the week of the week in a while because we haven't been doing these shows regularly and frankly hasn't been a guy worthy of the designation. But Eric Long was for sure the worst wrestler of all time of the week.
You know what's funny is he's in there with Tommy Angel. I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but Tommy Angel is the bane of my existence. He's absolutely horrendous. He looked like Okada here tonight. This fucking Eric Long. He can sort of bump, which means he could fall down. He could sort of sell, pretty much as good as any fan off the street. He absolutely could not take a buckle. He could not hit the ropes.
No.
He was atrocious. And the best part was, he was so bad, and the babyfaces decided that they were just going to keep this guy in the ring.
Mm-hmm. So, as you noted, he could not run the ropes.
No.
Now, sometimes we see a guy not run the ropes, and I'd say this man has never been in the ring before. Forget that. I don't think Chris Long had ever... It was Chris Long, right? Eric Long.
Eric Long.
Eric Long. I don't think Eric Long had ever run before. the ropes, on a track, in the street, anywhere. He'd never been in a hurry in his life. They go through this. They beat him up for a long time. They openly cheat. They tell the ref, yes, we are pulling the hair. We're going to do it again. Watch. Eventually, Bugsy pinned him with a splash. This was terrible in every way.
Horrible.
Completely without merit. Then Jimmy and Bugsy cut a promo.
Did we talk about how he had his arms down when he ran the ropes? My pet peeve.
It's a good one.
Yeah, he hits the ropes with both arms down by his sides. Like, usually, as everyone is well aware, you grab the rope with one arm and the rope is in your armpit. If you're a luchador, your other hand grabs the middle rope. He had both arms down by his sides. He would hit the ropes and just bounce back in the middle of the ring. Absolutely horrible. And then, like I said, they wouldn't let him out of the ring.
No.
They would not let him out. He's just taken a beating, and then he gets so tired that the one thing that he could do, fall down, he couldn't even do by the end. He started doing the deal where he bumped on his ass. It's horrible.
Then Jimmy and Bugsy cut a promo, talking about commercials and making movies. Crowd loved Bugsy for reasons that completely escaped me.
Loved both of them. They went crazy for both these guys.
And then I'm just going to read what I wrote down here. He, meaning Bugsy, talked about bulges and bears and kinky bears. And he and Jimmy screamed, and they left. And they put up a graphic saying that if we had a headache, we should stay tuned. And I swear to the good Lord above, I am not making a single word of this up.
Well, you know, if I watched this, I'd have a headache afterwards.
Yeah.
Not going to lie. I finally figured out, I mean, it wasn't finally, but Bugsy and Jimmy, there's a big difference between the two guys. Bugsy strikes me as a normal guy who is pretending to be Jimmy Valiant.
Okay.
He's a guy who goes home and he takes off his gimmick and, you know, eats dinner. He's a normal fella. He's just a guy.
Mm-hmm.
He's a guy playing a crazy pro wrestler. Jimmy Valiant strikes me as a guy who goes to the grocery store in his tights.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. For sure.
He always, you know, and part of the reason for that is because he's been on the show and he was in character the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe that he's ever not Jimmy Valiant. I believe Jimmy Valiant. I don't buy Bugsy McGraw for 2 seconds. That's the big difference.
That is a big difference. Barry Windham versus John Savage. It was like watching Chris Jericho and Kenny Omega in the Tokyo Dome after watching that opener. They went 3 minutes. Barry won with a lariat. Anything to add?
I would say that John Savage looked like the son of the Barbarian.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
Just want to throw that in there.
Yeah. So Windham cuts a promo. Mike Rotundo's out there.
It's a hideous promo. That's what I'll throw in here.
Well, both of them were.
This promo was horrible here.
Barry says that he's got his UWF title match with Steve Williams coming up at Starrcade, and friendship's going to go out the window when the championship is on the line. And then things got worse, because Mike Rotundo says, you know, a lot of wrestlers have been forgetting about their wrestling with all the hoopla going on, but that's good for me because nobody can beat me at wrestling. Now, I know there are no drugs in this business, but if there were, I would say Mike Rotundo may have been high here.
Well, you know, he just, I don't know. My favorite was they do this horrible interview, and then they're done, and David says, we got a Starrcade update coming up next. And they said, can't wait to hear it.
Well, we did get the Starrcade report.
Starrcade Control Center.
From the Starrcade Control Center, which is just a desk with some TVs behind it.
Yes.
So the official name
of the show. What the hell's this cat doing? God damn, anything else going to happen here?
It's been a day, folks.
Son of a bitch.
It has been a day. I'll just keep talking. The official name of the show is now Starrcade 87, Chi-Town Heat, Glory Bound, which is a total mouthful. They announced a new match for the show, a six-man tag.
What the hell? Let's talk about how this day started. So we're experimenting with doing some video here. So the studio's lighting sucks. It's got some stupid light bulbs up above us right here, and we're trying to think about, okay, well, let's get some better light bulbs, blah, blah, blah. So Tony sends me a link to Amazon where I can get some very bright light bulbs. I'll put some bright light bulbs up here, and it's going to help brighten up the studio for this video. How are these goddamn light bulbs? I'm like, why the fuck? $85 for 6 light bulbs? Like, first off, these things better be, these better be like those light bulbs on the fire station from 1906 that are still glowing here in 2017. I order them. I next day them, because we need them by Tuesday. And I'm waiting for them to arrive. Finally, first off, by the way, this fucking Amazon driver, it's not his fault. He doesn't know what's in the package. But he zooms in. He gets out of his unmarked white van, which, by the way, could you get a creepier delivery service than an unmarked white van? He fucking throws the box at the front door.
Hmm.
Yeah. Luckily, they're packed in styrofoam. I fucking open, like, I pull out the first bulb. It's in a box. I swear to God, the box is like, I don't know, a foot and a half long?
It must have been.
It's right there. What is that, a foot and a half?
Eh, a little more than a foot.
Okay, so it's a little more than a foot. I'm thinking, God, they must fucking, I mean, it's an Amazon delivery, so it's got to be, you know, thrown at my front door. They must pack that bulb in so much foam. And I'm thinking, is it really one bulb per package? They don't have like three bulbs in there?
It's like the box is the size and shape of a loaf of bread.
So, yeah. I open up the goddamn box. This light bulb is at least a foot long.
It's enormous.
It's a foot long, and it's as big around as your calf.
Sure.
I was going to say my cock, but no one's seen that. Anyway, what the fuck? Are you kidding me? Now I got six of these. What in the fuck am I going to do with six giant light bulbs?
Are there even six outlets in this room?
What's up, love? She just opened the door. You hear me talking about my cock? Is that why you opened up the door? She just nodded her head. Six fucking giant-ass light bulbs I got here that are completely useless. Jesus. That's how this day started.
Did things go uphill from there or downhill?
No. Then I was trying to change the filter in the garage. I almost killed myself. Then I come up here and just one thing after another here on this show. The fucking cat.
Yeah. It's been a day.
I think that's everything.
Okay.
This button didn't work. I had to change
that's
this
your
fucking
audio
button.
Didn't work for
I had
no
to
reason.
Switch some goddamn setting. I'm trying to make this easy for everybody.
This mic hasn't worked well.
Instead,
my
it's bullshit.
Yeah.
No, the mic is working. I just had it up too high.
Yeah, this is the
mine wasn't even working when I started the show.
That's true. Well, here in the Starcade update from the Starcade Control Center for Starcade 87 Chi-Town Heat Glorybound, they announced a new match, a trios match. Some luchadors.
Yeah, did you write down all these matches? I didn't write down any.
Well, there was only one new one.
Okay.
The only new one was this trios match of Jimmy Garvin, Michael Hayes, and Sting versus Eddie Gilbert, Rick Steiner, and Larry Zbysko.
Rob Rex Steiner.
Michael Hayes called him that. He called him by his real
That's
name.
That's what they called him, Rob Rex Steiner. Yeah. I loved it.
So they move on to the TV title unification match.
May I? I rewound this eight times to write this down.
Have at it.
Because it wasn't an easy sentence, apparently. Jim Crockett Jr., in his fucking monotone, completely uncharismatic voice. And I love the guy, but he is not a fountain of charisma. He is a black hole of charisma. He says, Commissioner John Ayers was totally ineffective in his efforts in getting the thief, Terry Taylor, to return the championship trophy to Nikita Koloff. Fuck, I fucked it up again. But that's what he said. Commissioner John Ayers was totally ineffective in his efforts in getting the thief, Terry Taylor, to return the championship trophy to Nikita Koloff. I died.
It was awesome because, as you noted, he is not a fountain of charisma.
No.
So 99% of people would have watched this and just thought it was a blank, emotionless expression.
Yes.
If you watch Jim Crockett every week, this was such a massive air of disappointment.
He was so gravely disappointed.
He had such hope for this John Ayers fella.
It's John Ayers, football star.
John Ayers, football star, had let him down. Completely ineffective. It was awesome. They replayed the angle from last week with Hiro Matsuda attempting to end the life of Tommy Young and Johnny Weaver making the save. This leads to Dusty Rhodes, what was supposed to be Dusty, cutting a promo on Hiro Matsuda. That is kind of what we got.
Well, forget, before we even get to the promo, there's a recap of Hiro Matsuda nearly ending the life of a referee. And everything else that went down in this. This is a very serious angle, okay? Yeah. Life and death is at stake right here. They cut to Dusty Rhodes. He's chilling out. in a fucking Hawaiian shirt, and his goddamn cowboy boots are up on the desk.
Sunglasses inside. Not a care in the world.
He's just chilling. He chills his way through this promo. God bless the guy, but they keep zooming in on his head as he's talking, and his absolutely gigantic fat neck just fills up the entire screen. And he's just all about how legendary he is. I am so legendary, and I have no equal. He claims that his career and his life are on the line in this match with Lex Luger.
You said that.
By the way, just remember that. His career and his life are on the line.
So he rambles all over the place, talks about losing Magnum TA in the blink of an eye. He signed a contract to face Lex Luger for the U.S. title at Starrcade. U.S. title has never been around his waist, although he is, in fact, a legend with no equal. Said his life was on the line. To beat the legend, he had to beat the legend. His career and livelihood could be gone in a split second.
His career and his livelihood.
So, I didn't really know what was going on, but they went back to the control center and clarified, yes, the Rhodes-Luger match would be title versus career. Okay, fine. Title versus career, the young champion versus the old legend. This is a perfectly plausible setup for a match. I mean, they already established that Dusty wants the match so badly that he'll agree to any stipulation Lex wants. So
any stip.
So fine. This is all fine and dandy. J.J. Dillon is there. He says, Mr. Crockett, I looked over this printed contract you have here. It does not match up with the terms we had discussed verbally. It says right here that Dusty Rhodes, should he lose, will be banned from wrestling in the United States for 30 days. Now, well, this is bullshit. No wonder Dillon's pissed. Dusty said he put his career on the line, not in the U.S. for 30 days. So Dillon has 2 points. First point is, Dusty is not just a U.S. wrestling star. Dusty is a global wrestling star.
Yes.
He can go to Japan. He can go to Africa. He can go to Mexico. He can wrestle anywhere. You promote those places, Mr. Crockett. You'd benefit from it, too. We want this to be a global ban, not a U.S. ban. I thought he's got a good point. Dillon's standing up for himself. Then he says, we want this to be, you know, we want Dusty's career at stake. We don't want this to be 30 days. We want this to be 90 days.
90 days.
3 months. Was he going to retire in January? And so this just wipes out the last part of that? How is 90 days a career?
Listen, J.J. Dillon needs a new lawyer. Contract on the line, he says, it's not 30 days no wrestling in the U.S. It should be 90 days no wrestling around the globe.
Yeah.
Now listen, career on the line should mean you're retired as a full-time wrestler worldwide.
Yeah.
Maybe you come back for a match here and there, whatever, who gives a shit. But in general, you're done. They tried to explain later on in the show that if you're gone from wrestling for 90 days, it's out of sight, out of mind, and nobody's going to remember your name. Right. Now listen, I'm not the biggest fan of Dusty during this era. If you've listened to any shows, that's abundantly clear. But let me fucking tell you something. Nobody's forgetting about Dusty Rhodes in 90 days. No one's forgetting about Dusty Rhodes in 90 months, and I'm sure no one's forgetting about Dusty Rhodes in 90 years. This storyline sucked.
Hiro Matsuda has not been seen on the show in years.
Years!
Way more than 90 days, and they made him a main event guy in one show.
Hey, listen, what the hell's his name? The New Breed.
New Breed guy.
That guy's been out for 90 days. He comes back, he's right back there in the mix.
Yeah.
So anyway, this storyline sucks. They're off the rails here.
It does. Mighty Wilbur versus David Isley. Wilbur wins in seconds with a Polish hammer and this big splash.
Then cuts the greatest promo of all time.
Now, you got to understand something here. We're going to describe what's going on and what he says, and we'll try to imitate him. And
yes.
It's going to come off sounding horrible.
All I got to know is he was very close to going into the Hall of Awesome. Okay? He's not in there, all right? But man, oh man.
So, before he starts talking about Paul Jones, and Crockett's like, wait, we'll get to that. Tell us about yourself. Where did you come from?
Sure. Now, before Vinny even answers, okay, Mighty Wilbur, a big, fat, redneck hillbilly. Where do you come from? Just imagine for those of you that have never seen Mighty Wilbur, maybe you've seen Giant Haystacks Calhoun. Mm-hmm. Not Giant Haystacks.
Hillbilly Jim.
Hillbilly Jim. Okay? Imagine a Hillbilly Jim or a Haystacks Calhoun. Where does a guy like that come from?
Kentucky.
Maybe Kentucky. Maybe the Appalachians.
The Appalachians. Virginia, maybe.
Virginia. Where the fuck is Mighty Wilbur from?
Hayward, California.
Hayward, California? What?
Well, as he explained, he says, I'm from Hayward, California. I've been working hard, picking fruits, working the vineyards.
He's a vintner!
He is a vintner. A lot of hard work, you know, he explains. And I met Red Bastien.
At a 7-Eleven.
At a 7-Eleven.
Yes.
This is where he met Red Bastien. Said there was a old lady had some trouble with a mugger, and I took care of that right away, and Red Bastien got me into wrestling.
He took one look at me, and he got me into the wrestling business.
So, hooked me up with Paul Jones, and I don't know. I don't like the way Jones treats his wrestlers. I don't like the way Jones treats the people. I watched Paul Jones tear up a young man's autograph book. Looks in the camera. Young man, if you're watching, I promise next time I see you, you're getting an autographed picture of the Mighty Wilbur. He says, hi to Mom and Josh and Ike.
Mom and Josh and Ike.
Back in California.
Yep.
Said he hoped to do well while he was here. Jimmy says, that's a big man with a good heart.
I don't know if it's a big man with a good heart or a good man with a big
heart. That's true. Maybe the other way around.
One or the other.
All I know is, this was 100%. You talked about this with Jimmy Valiant. This was totally believable.
Oh, my God.
There's no doubt in my mind that this man was picking grapes in California, bumped into Red Bastien in a 7-Eleven, may or may not have had an incident with a mugger, but I'm convinced that he was a farm worker who ran into Red Bastien and got into wrestling, and now he's happy to be here and going to do his best. I believe every word of that.
He was so convincing, this Mighty Wilbur. And he came off as the most genuine, likable guy, like him and Lance Russell, the two nicest, most genuine baby faces in the history of wrestling. That's how he came off in this interview right here. I was just watching this thinking, this guy'd be my world champion. I could do so much with this baby face here.
He was pretty awesome.
He was unbelievable here. This was the best promo.
New Breed versus Gladiator number 1 and Bob Riddle.
And they're back.
Chris Champion's back after, as we noted, way more than 90 days. Still got a cast on his arm, and because he's from the future, the cast has all sorts of circuitry and wiring on it to make his arm heal faster.
Yeah, keep in mind he's been out like months and
months
with a broken arm from an auto accident, and he still has this goddamn cast on. So whatever it's doing, I mean, that was either a serious amputation... Or he needs to go old school with just a regular cast.
Throwing the arm back all the way, yeah. So they take this squash match, they beat him up, and they go for their finish, and they hit what I can only call an elevated flying teabag, where Sean Royal holds a man up, and Champion comes off the top rope with a sit-down splash and lands on his face, and I'm almost positive, in all seriousness, one of them shouted something about his nutsack.
It was a heart attack with a sit-down splash off the middle rope.
Yes.
Botched, I wrote.
It was also botched. They nearly sat on the guy's head and killed him.
Now, the only good thing about this was, I mean, nothing. But I did like when Chris Champion, with his futuristic cast, came off the top rope with a double sledge using the cast. And I just wish that when he hit the guy, it would have went like, zzz. The guy would have started shaking.
Or sparks fly off.
Yeah, it's an electrified, loaded cast that he uses a weapon.
Ronnie Garvin came out for a promo. The world heavyweight champion wearing a t-shirt.
A green shirt.
A green t-shirt. Jeans, probably acid washed. And suspenders.
White suspenders and sunglasses indoors.
And sunglasses indoors. Now, I was about to bury him, but I said, you know what? It was the 1980s. And I stopped there, but hold that thought. So Garvin's screaming a lot this week. He screams, the Starrcade is not going to be easy. It's going to be a fight. Flair's going to learn he's in there with a real man. I'm younger than Flair. I'm stronger than Flair. I'm faster than Flair. And Chicago's going to go down in history. This wasn't bad.
It's all right. He did mention that he kept going on and on about how he was a real man. He was a champion. He was a real man. And he goes, Rick, when you touch me, you'll be touching a real man.
Yeah, that line could have been rewritten better.
This is not the best promo I've ever heard. I want to see a fight.
Yeah. Ivan Koloff and the Warlord versus Rick Ryder and Rex King.
Yeah.
See, most of these guys are just jobbers for life, with the exceptions of Big Bubba. And Rex King went on to be, well, Rex King of the Southern Rockers, and then well done.
Yeah.
So he accomplished a lot more than most of these guys.
So the fans are chanting Puddinheads to Paul Jones, and I can't believe that you or anybody else did not alert me that, in fact, there was a Puddinhead Jones, the baseball player.
I was not aware.
Yes, and I looked at his Wikipedia, and maybe there's more that I have not seen, but judging from his Wikipedia, he does not appear to be like a complete embarrassment. He was a Major League Baseball third baseman, played for the Philadelphia Eagles, Cleveland Indians, Cincinnati Reds, batted and threw right-handed, a .258 hitter with 190 home runs, 812 RBIs.
15 seasons.
1691 games played.
Puddinhead Jones is a pretty good player.
Yeah, so I'm not sure why calling Paul Jones Puddinhead Jones was so devastating to Paul Jones.
Puddinhead Jones, the baseball player, died in 1983.
Mm-hmm.
I'm guessing it's a coincidence. And Paul Jones just didn't like the name Puddinhead. So Koloff and Warlord are doing this match. And Jones is on commentary. Claims Wilbur has embarrassed me. He's humiliated me. He has a brain the size of a pea. Chris Crockett asks, how did you let a man with a brain the size of a pea humiliate and embarrass you? Jones looks at him. He picks grapes.
He can't even talk. He's a fruit picker.
I bet he only picked them off the ground. He didn't have the guts to pick them off the vine.
What the fuck does that even mean?
I don't know, but it's amazingly awesome.
I also loved Paul Jones says, I can't believe Red Bastine would hold a grudge this long. So the story is him. You know, this is so amazing because, like, I used to always hate in TNA where they would just, like, make up a storyline out of thin air. It's like, if we never saw what you're talking about, you can't just make up a storyline and make us care. Incorrect. You can if you know what you're doing. We have never seen Red Bastine on this show.
No.
Ever. But the storyline has been created that Red Bastine and Paul Jones at one point must have been feuding. This was years and years ago. Well, Red Bastine held a grudge, his feud with Paul Jones, and he found this man. He found this mighty Wilbur, this good old country boy who could not be turned to the dark side.
No.
And he knew that Paul Jones was searching for the final member of his army. Because, of course, we all know Red Bastine must watch NWA World Championship. Who doesn't?
Of course.
And he came up with a plan. I'm going to send the mighty Wilbur sight unseen to Paul Jones. And Paul Jones will be embarrassed and humiliated. That's the backstory. It's fucking awesome. I'm begging to see Red Bastine show up on this show now. And give Paul Jones a beating.
So Jones's men win here with the backbreaker elbow smash combo. And then they go to the desk where Jones continues his promo. Now, the great thing here is this is something only a heel would do. He's so humiliated and embarrassed by what Mighty Wilbur did to him that he must explain it in graphic detail here on national television. Most people, when they get humiliated and embarrassed, they want to cover it up.
No.
Paul Jones wants the world to know specifically how he was made to look like a fool in front of the whole world.
He is practically in tears. He says, I could have made you a physical and mental giant.
Yes.
Because I guess the Mighty Wilbur wasn't a physical giant, even though he's like 500 pounds. I want him to know that as far as I'm concerned, he's dead meat. You humiliated me. You made fool of me in front of millions. And by the way, as he's ranting, he is whacking the table over and over with his fucking writing crop as he screams every word. He's His eyes are bloodshot. There are tears in his eyes. He's screaming about all of this. And then he goes, I'm not going to stand here and get upset.
I'm not going to get upset. I'm not going to holler.
I'm not going to stand here and holler, Wilbur. I'm just going to get the job done. Paul Jones, this close to going into the Hall of Awesome. He's this close because of this promo.
Just because of being Paul Jones. This was awesome. And Paul Jones versus Mighty Wilbur is currently the hottest feud in Jim Crockett Promotions.
Yes.
In 2 weeks of being on TV. And here's the amazing thing. This is not a main event feud. It's the absolute bottom of the roster feud.
Oh, man. It's mid-card for life.
Yeah. But they're still going with it and making it seem as important as they can. When you are mid-card on Raw, unless the thing has changed drastically in the last 6 months, everyone knows mid-card, you're mid-card and nobody cares. The show is built to make you not care. This show wants you to care about the mid-card. They're not going to lie to you and say it's more important than the World Championship or anything. But they're saying, we're going to put this on TV, even if it's on the low end of the totem pole of important things we're doing, we still want you to care about it. We still want it to matter. Everything matters in this show, which is why it's fun.
Hell yeah. Even the shit matters.
Even the shit matters. Ric Flair came out for a promo.
Oh, in all seriousness now, I need these sunglasses. Where can I get a pair? eBay? Somebody find out what these are. I need a pair.
I'm sure they're aviators of
I'll pay top dollar.
1987 variety.
I paid $80 for 6 light bulbs. Trust me, I'll buy these sunglasses.
Yep. So on the crazy Ric Flair scale, this is like a 5 or a 6.
But it was worth it because he buried Ron Garvin's suspenders.
He did.
First thing you notice when Ron Garvin did his promo was his fucking suspenders, uh-huh. And Flair would not let it go.
Like when I saw this, I thought, you know what? It is 87. Maybe the suspenders were cool at the time.
No.
Not to Flair.
No.
And Flair made it abundantly clear that pickup trucks and suspenders were not cool. If that's what Ronnie Garvin's going to spend his money on, I should be world champion. I'll spend it on better things. He said Dusty Rhodes was a millionaire. He was not the common man like he claimed to be. He ran down Garvin, ran down the Road Warriors, claimed to be in both GQ and Playgirl. And he promised the Horsemen would win a Starrcade and kiss the girls and make him cry.
I'm skeptical of those two magazines.
I am as well.
By the way, he claimed the Road Warriors had never been world champion before. I guess it's true.
Well,
it was 87.
Singles world champion.
I thought he was talking about like tag team champions.
And then they'd have been AWA champs by then.
But maybe the AWA didn't count in Ric Flair. Let me check here. Debuted in 83. They must have won a world title. This seems impossible.
I do remember it took them a long, long, way longer than you would think to win the world championships for Crockett.
All right, 83, 84, Georgia Championship Wrestling. They won the NWA National Tag Team titles upon their debut. They were AWA World Tag Team Champions. They started feuding with the NWA World Tag Team Champions, 84 to 86. NWA International Tag Team Champions.
Which I think was New Japan.
Yes, yeah. So that doesn't really count. And, NWA World Six-Man Tag Team Championship.
Gray area.
Yep. They finally won the NWA World Tag Team titles on October 29, 1988.
Yeah, so he's a year away from the show we just watched.
After turning heel. How about that?
Yeah.
How about that? Well, wonders never cease.
Michael Hayes and Jimmy Garvin versus Thunderfoot number 1 and Robbie Idol. They went a minute. Hayes pinned Idol with a bulldog. And then Hayes and Garvin cut a promo about Starrcade Fever.
First off, the match, it's just like what they used to do with Magnum. They keep the match quick. You got to pay to see him wrestle for any length of time.
True.
Can you imagine paying to see
Michael Hayes and Jimmy Garvin wrestle?
What the fuck? But that's what it was.
That's what happened.
They were well-loved baby faces.
They were. Garvin promised his brother was going to keep the world title. Said Dusty's going to win the U.S. title. And me and Hayes are going to have a good time in Chicago. And Hayes says, yes, that's right. We finally have opponents. International star Larry Zbyszko. International mouth runner Eddie Gilbert. And Rob Recksteiner.
Yeah.
Did he not know?
I don't know.
Was this a rib or what? He said nobody knew six-man tags better than him, and the heat was on. The promo was awesome. I am not doing it justice. It was actually better than the Flair promo. And Ric Flair is almost always the best promo on the show.
Let's see. Rick Steiner, Varsity Club. Doesn't say what his name was. Let's see. He initially wrestled under the name Rob Rex Steiner.
Now, there you go.
Yes, so he did.
And he had been in the UWF meeting. You saw him there.
Yeah.
Kevin Sullivan versus Terry Jones. Sullivan destroyed him in one with a foot stomp. He cuts a promo and steals Garvin's line about Starrcade fever. Hypes up all the matches at Starrcade, none of which he is in. And then says, Dusty, your career is on the line. Nothing you've done to this point matters. Doesn't matter that you played pro baseball or that you were with the Boston Patriots. I don't think Dusty ever played pro baseball or was with the Boston Patriots. But anyway.
You got to make a story.
He warns Dusty, this Nassau show, it's a trap. You had better watch your back in War Games. And I bet he meant it.
He's clearly a heel now.
Yeah. Well, the trap is clearly he's going to attack Dusty Rhodes and Nassau. He's just saying to the world.
Well, the Varsity Club is coming.
Yes. Which is great, by the way. Another Starrcade report. Crockett says he has talked to Dusty Rhodes. Dusty has agreed to all of Luger's demands. He will put his career on the line for 90 days around the world.
And it's a cage match. We have two cage matches coming up here at this Starrcade show.
That's right. So Jim Cornette's there. Let me see. Jim Cornette here is... Jim Cornette and the Midnight Express have been obsessed with the Rock and Roll Express. They've had a contract to face the Rock and Rolls for a while now, and the Rock and Rolls have signed it. And the Rock and Roll Express will meet the Midnight Express at Starrcade. And he like pauses there, and Cornette's just giddy. He's got the match he wants. And then Crockett continues his sentence, in a Skywalker's match.
Goddamn scaffold match is coming back.
Cornette barks like an angry dog.
He goes, ah!
He goes in a rant. He wants no part of this match. Cornette, even in 1987, had to share history, real life history. He knows the Rock and Roll Express invented the scaffold match, and they did. They were the very first one in Memphis. So he knows they invented the match. It's their perfection. There's no way they're going up there. He's going to sue Jim Crockett. He's going to sue all his shyster lawyers. And if they do end up on that scaffold somehow, then by God, there's going to be nobody up there to stop them from doing whatever they wanted, and somebody's going to get their neck broke. That was great.
He says, we will do everything humanly possible to send the Rock and Rolls head first off the scaffold. It'll be the day the music died. And by the way, he's just out of his mind, talking a million miles an hour as Jim Cornette does. He's going crazy. He's cutting his promo. It's day the music died. Go back to Schiavone. Fans will be right back. Totally no-sells this madman.
Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson, the original members of the Hall of Awesome.
Yes, the founding members of the FRW Hall of Awesome.
Versus Keith...
With J.J. Dillon.
Yes.
He's part of this as well.
Versus Keith Steinborn and Alan Martin. The announcers pointed out, hey, you know, Tully and Arn don't have a Starrcade match yet. Match was short. Arn pinned Steinborn with the Spinebuster and Gourdbuster.
I have nothing to add.
You go to commercial, they come back, and it's Mike Rotunda versus Alan Martin.
Was he not in the last match?
If you were not paying attention, it was at least introduced that Alan Martin was in the last match. Now, Keith Steinborn was definitely the guy who got pinned. I'm pretty sure Alan Martin actually wrestled. It wasn't just a graphical error.
Are you sure that he wasn't like in the match, but he never actually got in, and so they just gave him another chance to get his win bonus? That's the only thing I can
figure. I'm not sure that didn't happen. So, it didn't work. He got double duty and a Florida title match and still didn't win. Rotunda won in a minute with the airplane spin. New Breed came out for a promo.
Oh my God, what in the fuck? You know what they were wearing? They looked like villains in a 1950s sci-fi movie about Martians.
Yes.
Just with way worse haircuts.
Yes. Haircuts were more intricate. So, Chris Champion is the one who was away and is back with his arm in a cast with circuitry on it. He says, you try to take my partner out of wrestling. Like three Xandorian night beasts.
Dude.
Jim Cornette and the Midnight Express had tried to take Sean Royal out.
Are those real things, you geek?
No.
Okay.
Not to my knowledge.
I thought you might
actually... It might be, actually. I'm not familiar with them.
Tell me about these animals.
I'll look it up here shortly. So they ran down the Midnight Express with a bunch of silly names.
They're baby faces now.
Just out of the blue, yeah.
Yes. So they said Cornette was lucky that they were not in the scaffold match because they were born on a scaffold. Said Cornette's real last name is not Cornette, it is Lee, and made jokes about his family members, Fug Lee,
yeah,
and Dumb Lee.
In 1987, Sean Royal said Fug Lee on TV.
Yeah, because he's from the future. This was fucking terrible. It was the second worst promo of all time behind Bugsy McGraw, but I laughed.
There's things like Sour Stan and Ugly Bobby, and I think it's a Big Blubber.
Yeah, Big Blubber, yeah. Rogers.
Yeah. Rock and Roll Express versus Larry Stevens and Tony Suber.
Only thing notable is the greatest finish of all time.
A literal schoolboy.
One Rock and Roll is on his hands and knees. The other Rock and Roll does a high cross and bumps the guy over the aforementioned on all fours Rock and Roll and gets the pin.
Okay, the only thing I found on Sandorian Night Beast is reference to other New Breed promos. So they made it up. They cut a promo hyping up the scaffold match.
Yeah. Quick, fiery promo.
It was. Midnight Express versus the NWA Jobber Dream Team of Italian Stallion and George South.
Yeah, it was sad this didn't get more time. This could have been a really good match.
They could have had like a good 15-minute wrestling match here.
It's a good thing it didn't go longer because Cornette was in the booth ranting and raving and he didn't take one breath, so he probably would have died if it would have gone much longer.
Sure.
Seems like such hard work.
Being Jim Cornette? Yes. Yeah. He accused the Rock and Rolls of stealing their moves. And his team won with a rocket launcher.
Yeah, it was a fine little match.
JJ and Lex come out for a promo.
This was where they claimed that if Dusty lost this match, he would be out of wrestling for 90 days. That meant that everybody would forget who Dusty Rhodes was.
So they tried. Said,
JJ's lucky went to the Hall of Awesome. This was a failure of a promo.
In top-level sports, you can miss one game, and you're out of the lineup, and somebody takes your place, and you're just yesterday's news. Imagine how many people would take your spot in 90 days.
Imagine if we didn't see Dusty wrestle on TV for 90 days. Oh! I don't think we've ever seen him wrestle on TV.
So Lex got a really good promo here.
Got a hell of a promo.
This may have been better than the Flair promo earlier, and I don't think you will rarely say that.
Not in the Hall of Awesome.
No.
But I gotta say that this man, Lex Luger, never got the credit he deserved.
No.
No, I stand by that. I've seen a lot of Luger. I see more every week. This guy got a bum rap. Not saying he should have been like the next Ric Flair or anything like that, but Luger is just like, over the years, he just gets buried and buried and buried and buried. He was not a bad promo.
No.
He was not a horrible wrestler.
No.
He was fucking mega over.
Yes.
Every time he got the ball, they took the ball away from him.
Also true.
All those times in WCW, he never got a chance.
Also, by the way, Lex Luger himself not in the Hall of Awesome, but maybe his outfit here, the ultimate 1980s preppy douchebag outfit of the white sweater over the pink polo shirt with the collar popped.
Mm.
Good stuff. So he vowed that Dusty had bitten off more than he could chew. This is the second most prestigious championship in the sport, and it was going to be his night to shine. Eddie Gilbert came out for a promo, got the TV belts over his shoulder. Starts running down Starrcade matches and says all of that is secondary. What every wrestler is going to be paying attention to is who's better, the NWA or the UWF? And we're going to find out once and for all when Terry Taylor takes on Nikita Koloff. No. Just no. I thought this is almost as ludicrous as the claim Dusty Rhodes would be forgotten in 90 days.
But you know what? He did good delivery.
He did his
best. Of this preposterous promo.
Sure. Ricky Santana versus Thunderfoot number 2.
Okay, this fucking Thunderfoot. So, this match went like a minute, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Because they're running out of time. Thunderfoot gets backdrop. He lands right on his ass. Now, Ricky Santana's like, well, goddamn, let's try it again. Backdrops the guy a second time. He lands right on his ass. Ricky Santana looked pretty good.
Sure.
And here's I just want to mention something right here. Ricky Santana, Hispanic babyface,
mm-hmm.
comes out here. They do a sprint bell to bell, hits a Thez press off the top for the pin. Dave quickly runs over to interview him because they're almost out of time. Santana cuts his promo in both English and Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
I will bet you that in all of the time that we watch this television, we never see Ricky Santana do a job. I'll bet you anything. That is one of the strengths of a television show that has jobber matches, as opposed to the current Monday Night Raw, where you can only wrestle other big names on the roster.
Yeah.
How long do you think Ricky Santana would go in WWE before he did a job? 3 weeks?
Tops. The very tops.
I mean, come on. They're going to beat this guy. But the key to a Hispanic draw or any foreign draw, if you're a non-American in an American promotion and you're trying to draw, like if you're Japanese or if you're Hispanic or whatever, the key to drawing those fans to your shows to see that guy wrestle is he needs to be a winner. Ricky Santana was a good worker. He cut a good promo in English. He cut a good promo in Spanish. A very good, fiery, ethnic babyface star.
Sure.
Don't beat the guy.
That's
my entire point. Just come out here and win squashes. He can lose here and there if he needs to, if he has to, at a house show or a live event. But, like, never beat him on television. And he'll draw for you. WWE beats every hometown guy and every ethnic star. They mean nothing.
Of course.
They don't draw one single.
Yes.
I mean, Rey Mysterio did for a while, but, I mean, he's like the only one.
Six-time NWA Pacific Northwest Tag Team Champion Ricky Santana.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Also, one-time Catch Wrestling Association Tag Team Champion with, I'm not making this up, Black Navy SEAL.
Really?
That's what it says.
Black Navy? I'll have to investigate that guy. I've never heard of Black Navy SEAL. Who is it?
It just says Black Navy SEAL.
Not going to help to Google this.
No. Won a championship with Sean Morley, who'd be Val Venus.
Navy SEAL. Wrestler. Cage match. Also known as Black Navy SEAL. Terrence Black, Rasta Man, Reggae Man, Leroy Howard, and Anthony Howard. This guy's got more aliases than anybody. 1990 to 2005, trained by Jimmy Del Rey.
I think I remember him as the... Was Voodoo Man one of those names you said?
Let me see.
Was a Voodoo Man like the global?
No, Reggae Man.
Reggae Man, I'm sorry.
Or Rasta Man.
Rasta Man.
No, Voodoo Man.
Rasta's the man I was thinking of. But,
yeah. Well, he is here on Facebook.
I was like, Rasta the Voodoo Man. Is that the guy?
Former pro wrestler and current counselor in mental health, member of Omega Psi Phi. I'm sure I pronounced that wrong. I never went to college. That's fucking Greek.
Now that you're bitter about it.
Anyway. Well, it's time. Hey,
all right, we have songs and the Hall of Awesome.
Let's play our song first, then we'll do the Hall of Awesome. This will be a good lead-in. What's so funny?
Well, I was looking up Rasta the Voodoo Man, who I don't...
That's a different guy.
The different guy, but he did, in fact, in Finding Amanda, he played Black Guy Number One.
Really?
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
Can I just say real quick, I mentioned this on Twitter, but I was watching watching TV with the in-laws at Christmas Day, and a Jumanji commercial came on, and my niece referred to the star of this film as Dwayne Rock the Johnson. Rock the Johnson.
Rock the Johnson.
Yes, I like that rock. He was good.
He's very good, isn't he?
Out he was. Yeah.
Very charismatic guy. Good worker.
Yeah.
Great movie star. Handsome.
Okay.
His legs were very shiny in 98. And I was going to wait till the Filthy show to play this next song, but I'm not sure that... I don't know if there's going to be a Filthy show this week, because I think it's going to be traveling to MLW, so I'll just play it right here. Watching this match, it's all right. Picks up at the end. Jinder climbs his way up onto the middle rope. And Jinder is standing there on the middle rope, and he puts his left hand in front of him, palm up, and he takes his right hand, and he starts chopping into his own hand.
Right.
And he's chopping, and he's chopping, and he's chopping. He's waiting for AJ to get up, and he's chopping. And I'm like, what the fuck is he doing? Like, is he going to give him a karate chop? Fucking AJ gets to his feet, and Jinder jumps high in the air, and he karate chops AJ on the top of the head.
Well, I'll stand up next to my bed, and I'll chop it down from the edge of my hand.
And he's chopping. 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 And he's chopping.
At the one and only.
I got some more here, but let's go ahead and do some of this NWA, and I'll find another one here at the end.
Retro NWA Halloween Night, October 31st, 1987. Michael Hayes and Gorgeous Jimmy. That's what the graphic said.
Not Gorgeous Jimmy.
Not Jimmy Garvin. Gorgeous Jimmy. Versus Gladiator number one and Gladiator number two. The Gladiators were out there like two big fat blueberries. Just all blue and all round. And the Freebirds looked good for a while, but then this went longer than it needed to. And Hayes eventually won with a bulldog.
Exciting.
Is it customary on these shows for the babyface to throw on a blatant rape choke in front of the ref?
It can be. It depends on who the babyface is.
Well, that's what Michael Hayes was doing here.
We didn't see Jimmy Valiant on the show, but like 80 to 90% of his offense is blatantly illegal.
You talking about Michael Hayes' cock yet?
I knew you were going to talk about this.
Dude, what in the fuck was he wearing?
Not baby, underwear.
Baby blue long tights and clearly no underwear. I was like...
It was pretty graphic.
Must we... First off, it's national television. Second off, if you're going to wear that, can you quit humping towards the camera? Gladiators are dressed like two blueberries from Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. They're fucking gladiators. You can't... Yeah. Like, if you're going to use the gimmick the gladiator, like, get a gladiator outfit, right?
Sure, yeah.
Something? Why the fuck are they blueberries?
I don't know.
Why aren't they Blueberry 1 and Blueberry 2? Who gives a shit? They're jobbers.
That would
so
be
they,
awesome.
They were dressed like blueberries, and Michael Hayes' pants were dressed like a mushroom.
Yes.
I was going to say that he was, like, transporting blueberries or something. This was just too much for me.
We're off to a hot start here.
No, so, it was not hot.
Then they cut a promo hyping up Starrcade Fever.
Jimmy Garvin's out of his mind with Starrcade Fever.
He says, I'm so excited, I'm going to kiss my wife while Michael does all the talking. And he did. So Michael does all the talking. And he calls out their six-man tag match they have for the pay-per-view and teaming with Sting against Larry Zbysko and Eddie Gilbert and Rick Steiner. And also, they wanted to call out Tully and Arn for the tag titles. Who got challenged out there? Larry Stevens versus Ricky Santana.
Oh, man. I put over Ricky Santana so hard last week.
One week ago.
And then they present me with this shit.
Ricky Santana makes his debut, and it's fun. It's action-packed, and he cuts this promo, and he gets himself over to the Latino fans. One week later, here he is. He is Latin Tim Horner. Armbar.
No, I was begging for Tim Horner and Brad Armstrong. This was so boring.
Went off like 5 minutes of arm bars. Santana hit an elbow and a high cross for the win.
It's always kind of like, I used to think this with the Brad Armstrong matches. It's like, why didn't you just do that earlier? Why did you make me sit through an hour of arm bars if all you had to do was deliver one forearm and a high cross off the top? What in the fuck? I mean, come on.
It seemed to me like they screwed something up and then Santana was like, I'm going to make you pay for that. And just threw the armbar on. It was so bad that Crockett started hyping up a local high school wrestling team. And did you notice Tony on the mic? He almost had the pin. He almost slipped it in. And then he went back to that. He almost slipped it in again. What is he talking about?
That sounds lewd.
Yeah, it's disgusting.
We have the Starrcade Control Center.
I love the Starrcade Control Center.
Even this week?
Well, I mean, it wasn't very good, but I love the idea of it. They're trying so hard to convince you that this is the biggest event of all time. Here are the upcoming matches. Here's the angle.
This is so important. We must set up a control center, which has monitors with showing wrestling from all over the world, so we can all maintain and keep up on current events in the sport as they pertain to Starrcade Chi-Town Heat. So the first thing they do...
Crockett says, well, you know, we got the tag team champions are here, Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson, and I've always wanted to see them challenge, or see the Road Warriors challenge them for the tag titles. They cut to a table. There's Sandy Scott, there's Paul Ellering, and there's J.J. Dillon. What in the hell was this?
Well, Vinny, you see, nowadays there's a thing called sports entertainment. Everything's got to be overproduced, and you got to wear suits and all this shit. Back then, there were athletes that were going to have a match, and so their representatives were just getting together to sign a fucking contract. What the hell do you have to do this, like, in a, you know what I mean? Just get together in a room and sign the goddamn papers.
Then don't put it on TV.
Well, you know, it's a big match. You need something for the Starcade Control Center.
Sandy Scott says, we have this tag team title contract for the Road Warriors and the Horsemen. Mr. Ellering, would you sign this, please? Ellering says, I'd like to say a few words first. We're waiting for this match for a long time. I'm going to make world history.
No, excuse me. Did you say he's going to make world history?
He's going to make world history.
Like the fall of Rome? Like World War II?
That's what he said.
Like, okay, just checking.
And then signs his name. He passes over to Dillon. I'm thinking, okay, JJ's going to say something smarmy. He's going to call the Road Warriors dumb. He's going to make fun of their makeup. Something interesting is going to happen. I overestimated J.J. Dillon. This was WCW Nitro with J.J. Dillon. In fact, even that's different. This was half asleep J.J. Dillon.
This was Filthy Tom is going to review the show, J.J. Dillon.
Yeah.
Because we put the guy in the Hall of Awesome, and then Filthy goes to watch the show and he gets this.
Yeah.
I won't lie. In all caps I wrote, this was hideously boring. It fucking sucked.
So JJ says the Warriors are top contenders. They deserve a title shot. It'll be a great match. And he signs, and that's that. There's more. We're not yet done in the control center. It got a little bit better. Just a teensy weensy bit better when Tully and Arn were talking. Tully says Jim Crockett's always out there to screw them, even when he's out there trying to hog their camera time. Now he's booking them against the Road Warriors in Chicago. But it doesn't matter. They get the job done. It doesn't matter how much you guys bench press. You're only 280 pounds each. We can double Gourdbuster you. And as Arn's running his mouth, they just show clips of the Warriors crippling jobbers. Just left and right. Traction, wheelchair, hospital bed. Over and over.
Tommy, you got to admit this Dick Murdoch, Tommy Angel, and Dick Murdoch promo were some pretty good stuff. Am I wrong?
Oh, yeah. It was all right. He killed him with a brain buster.
It's always a good thing.
He did kill him with a brain buster. He beat the shit out of him.
I'll tell you what. He took him down, just did like a waist lock takedown, went to a hammer lock or something. But he posts up, and he sneers at the crowd. Just doing that was the most exciting thing on the show so far. Emotion.
Wait, he's a great sneerer.
He has a great sneer. He has a beautifully ugly sneer.
Let's just cut forward.
Chanted. Egg-sucking dog, Adam.
Yes.
Need to bring that one back. I like that.
Yes. Now let's talk about this promo. This was amazing. Dick Murdoch calls Dusty Rhodes a coward. He says Dusty Rhodes is a coward for putting his career on the line against Lex Luger. Why would a man be a coward for putting his entire career on the line against a guy? Why, you see, this is a way for Dusty to avoid Dick Murdoch.
That's right.
He's attempting to retire. Then he will not have to face Dick.
Yes. None of us wants to face Dick. So, yes, he says, I broke Steve Williams' arm. I put Nikita Koloff on the shelf with a bad neck. And yes, Dusty's going to the coward Dusty Rhodes, the commie Dusty Rhodes. He's afraid to face a Marine like me. He challenged Dusty to fight him.
No, it's Nikita. Because they've been accusing Murdoch of being a vigilante or whatever. What was the word they used? He was
a bounty hunter.
A bounty hunter. And he says, listen, they call me a bounty hunter. I was proud to drop Nikita on his head for free because I'm a United States Marine and Nikita is a communist. And he was dripping. So this promo was so awesome.
This was one of the best things we saw all night. Ivan Koloff and Warlord versus David Isley and Rocky King.
I'm trying to make this show exciting.
The heels clobbered them for a while, and they won with a backbreaker elbow combo.
Go ahead, Tom.
Hold on. I will say first, Warlord, I know I've said this before, but was a former bodyguard for Kimbo Slice and a big Seth Petruzzelli fan. And the heels won with an Argentine
Maybe you should have teamed with him then.
The heels won with an Argentine backbreaker. And actually, what happened was Ivan Koloff went up to the second rope and he came off, and he chopping, and he chopping.
It was an elbow chop.
Chopped him right in the neck. No, I don't think it was an elbow. I think it was a chop.
We got to bring back the chopping block, or debut it. It's got to be next. Only other thing I'll add is, I did like that Paul Jones' crew here, the Warlord and Ivan Koloff, they choked Rocky King with a chain behind the referee's back. Rocky King. And he's never won a match on this show.
No.
They choked him with a chain because Paul Jones, as much as we love chopping, Paul Jones loves cheating. You cheat for the sake of it, not because you need to.
Win if you can, lose if you must, but always cheat.
Yes.
It's Jesse Ventura's thing, I think. Mighty Wilbur!
Oh, man, against Cougar J.
Mighty Wilbur against Cougar J. They're doing some stuff. It's boring. I don't know. There's one fan. I don't know if he was shouting at Wilbur or Cougar or just another fan. But he just shouts, get some Clearasil! I laughed. Wilbur wins the splash.
Do they still have that?
I'm sure they do.
Okay. Oh, they must.
I remember Clearasil.
I used a lot of it myself. Wilbur wins the splash. And it's time for a Mighty Wilbur promo.
Now, hold on a second here. Before we even get to the promo. Mighty Wilbur is just a good-natured country boy.
A vintner.
And they he's a vintner, that's right.
I beg to disagree.
Oh, get out of here.
To me, he seems like a condescending prick.
Oh, get out of here.
They're making faces the whole match
come
as
on.
He's in holds, showboating to the crowd as they're talking about how nice he is. What a likable guy. Looks like a jerk-off, if you ask me.
Wow.
He's just trying to have a good time and entertain the people.
Yes, he hits the Polish hammer. He's going for the splash, but he feels bad. I can't splash this man. I already Polish chopped him. And the fans, they start going, you gotta splash him. So, heck. Gosh darn. Gives him the big splash, pins the guy. Then he goes for his promo, where he begins, I hope I didn't really hurt the guy too much. Seems like a nice guy.
So Crockett asked about...
How did he figure he was a nice guy?
It seems what like a nice guy.
What in their interaction... That we saw on
he
there.
He looks like a nice
Cougar
guy.
Cougar J. Oh, he just looks like
He shakes hands with everyone before the match, and Cougar shook his hand back.
Sure, yeah.
What is Cougar J's gimmick here? What's the so Cougar about him?
He loses every week.
I was going to say, his gimmick is he sucks, and he drives me crazy because he's horrible.
So.
He has hair like a Cougar.
He did have a sweet mullet. That's true. Wilbur says, Crockett asked him about Puddinhead. Tell us about Puddinhead. And Wilbur's like, I don't really want to talk about Puddinhead so much. And he starts to mumble and loses his place.
No, he goes, I don't want to talk about Puddinhead. I want to talk about Paul Jones.
That's right.
But he means to say Ivan Koloff. But he screwed up.
I see.
And so to cover it, he goes, oh, man, I'm just nervous facing all these cameras. I'm not good at this.
He is the most lovable wrestler I've ever seen.
He's so awesome.
So he says, you know, I watched your match, Ivan Koloff. You put your Russian chain around an American man's neck. Well, I'm going to take an American chain and put it around your Russian neck.
And then...
If Puddinhead interferes, I'm gonna pluck his nose like an avocado. And there's a pause.
Yes.
And it's like he was expecting laughter and didn't come, so he says it again. I said, I'll pluck your nose like an avocado.
I laughed and laughed and laughed and
Hold
laughed.
On. Hold on. Vinny,
don't you
missed
dare.
A very important part, Vinny.
Okay.
He said, I'm going to pluck your nose off like an avocado. And Davy Crockett goes, yeah, I like that. And then he said it again.
There was too much greatness for me to recap in one segment.
Dude, I mean, I don't even know. Like, people go, you can't do a traditional babyface nowadays. This guy'd be the top guy on Raw.
Oh, for sure.
He's the top babyface.
Absolutely.
Who is a better babyface on Raw today than this guy? Seth? Are you kidding me?
I think Braun Strowman is just like 2018 Mighty Wilbur.
Dude, if Braun Strowman could do a promo like Mighty Wilbur, he's the next Hulk Hogan. Unfortunately, he can't. He just goes, ah!
Dozovich.
Oh, man, he's up there. It's a different kind of awesome.
Dylan, Lex Luger, and Hiro Matsuda came out for a promo.
Under Matsuda's name, it just reads Shogun.
So the story had been as I understood it, that Dusty was going to wrestle Lex Luger at Starrcade, but first, the Horseman had brought in Hiro Matsuda, the Shogun, to take Dusty out, or at least wear him down going into the match.
That happened. We saw footage of it.
Okay. Well, now the story is, Dusty's going to wrestle Lex at Starrcade, and then if he somehow survives that, then he'll have to deal with this man who, Lex says, he stays up at night, chewing on ginseng roots, thinking of ways to hurt people. I've never seen him sleep.
He sits in dark hotel rooms, chewing on it, ginseng root. He also says, Luger's talking about he's a world-class athlete, okay? He goes, I'm a man unlike any that you've ever seen. I have the best physique. I am the strongest. I am the fastest. I am the tallest. I was like, well, excuse me, what?
He did say that.
You're the tallest?
Yeah.
Okay, this is bullshit. Why the fuck did you add that? That is factually incorrect.
Maybe he meant of the three people right there.
Dude.
Mike Rotundo versus Thunderfoot number two. The highlight was when Thunderfoot tried to do a flip bump for Nanzagiri and bumped right onto his own head.
My God.
Crowd demanded an airplane spin, so Rotundo said okay, and he hit one, and he pinned him.
Yeah, great.
Midnight Express versus Ed Frank and Alan Martin.
Excuse me, Ed Frank?
That's what I wrote down.
Okay, Ed Frank's in the corner. Cornette says, clearly he's out of material. This Ed Frank looks like a Frankfurter, and they're going to wrap him up in a bun. What?
That's what they said.
Excuse me? You won best promo in 1987 off shit like that?
So, the highlight here, the first highlight was Bobby Eaton doing an angle slam.
I thought it was, the highlight was Cornette's tennis racket there.
Cornette's tennis racket, which had the Halloween-themed cover.
Yes,
had like
yes.
A scary cat on one side and a jack-o'-lantern on the other.
Yeah.
So the Midnight Express have this idea. It's Alan Martin who's on there every week.
Oh, God.
He's not one of the best jobbers, but he's better than some.
He's competent.
Yeah, usually. So the spot's going to be, we'll whip you in, you leapfrog over Bobby, and then Stan will hit you with basically a super kick, a sidekick, a savat kick.
Tom, this is why I don't go over spots. You got to just call it in the ring.
So Martin leapfrogs over Bobby, but he doesn't make it all the way. He lands on Bobby's back, essentially sitting there for a moment, and then he just pitches forward onto his face, and his face falls onto Stan's foot, and Stan just freezes with his foot still in the air. Yes. Like he never got to do his cool kick.
A fucking freeze frame. And then he just stops, as Vinny says, his leg is in the air, and then he just turns and he looks at Bobby. What the fuck? This guy couldn't even do a fucking leapfrog.
No. So the match continues. They take him outside. They punch him over by Cornette. They slam him on the floor for fucking up that move. And they go over the finish. They call it the Double Goozle.
Great name.
Stan hits him low. Bobby hits him high. It's kind of like Total Elimination. It should be a very basic move. You ever seen like at the gourmet candy shops where they got the taffy puller?
Oh, yeah.
That is what happened to Ed Frank here.
Beach.
Yes, exactly. Ed Frank got caught in a taffy pulley here called the Midnight Express and got yanked in all sorts of separate directions at once. They pinned him.
Show's a lot better than I remember watching it.
So they had clips.
They should have put Frank Furter on one of those, you know, those deals he put hot dogs on? It's got the thing and you skewer it.
You brand it?
Yeah. Like a,
it's
like
a hot
Vlad
dog.
The Impaler?
It's a hot dog spinner. Yeah. That's what they call it.
One of these jobbers also, they did the move where they like hold the guy's legs and they drape him across the rope and one guy jumps on his back. And Stan Lane did a cross body across his back. Like, are you kidding me? Almost broke him backwards in half.
Yeah.
Jobber matches, Tom.
Midnight Express jobber matches. They are going
to
get themselves over.
Anymore.
Yeah, I got to mention very quickly since we're talking about Frankfurters and Taffy.
You were talking about Frankfurters.
Yeah. So last night there's no UFC. I got nothing to do. I'm like, I'm gonna go see Star Wars. Down at McMenamin's there's a movie theater.
Hey, great.
Yeah, did you know that?
No, but
I knew there was, I didn't know where it was.
All right.
I go down there, I'm there for the 11:10 showing. I go in, I give the guy my money, and by the way, in the corner of the McMenamin's movie theater, there's a poster of Colonel McLaughlin, the wrestler from the 1800s.
How about that?
Yeah. So I buy my thing and I go, I just go through there? He goes, yeah. So I'm about to go through the door and he goes, I'll be here till 12:30 if you need anything. Like, okay, I guess I'll let myself out. So I go through the door, I go around the corner, there's fucking nobody in the theater. I had the entire theater all to myself the entire movie. It's like I had my own theater, like in my house. It's a minute down the road.
Excellent.
Yeah, I've turned on McMenamins now, the other way now. The babyface turn. I like this place. And man, they had some good popcorn.
Good to hear.
Oh man, it's great.
So Cornette's about to cut a promo. They show clips of the Midnight Express being attacked by a masked team called the Texas Cowboys. It was very clearly the Rock and Roll Express. And the gimmick was, well, Ricky explains it later. Cornette uses this to talk about the scaffold match, threatens his men will literally murder the Rock and Roll Express at Starrcade, throw them off, maybe into the ring, maybe into the concrete, and they won't feel bad about it.
This was a money promo here.
It was, but the best part about it was watching Stan and Bobby fuck around to entertain themselves.
I thought Stan fell asleep.
Stan's slumping on the podium. He's got his arm crossed in front of him. He's leaning on it. And he's just staring off into space. And Jim Cornette says, we're going to climb up that scaffold. And Stan doesn't move, but his eyes go up. And then Cornette says, and we're going to throw you down. And Stan's eyes go down. Just messing around. Meanwhile, over on the other side, Bobby Eaton has taken the tennis racket and he's just standing there holding it in front of Shivani's face. Just to not get him on TV. We need more stuff like this. Guys, just...
Well, you ain't going to get it, so
no.
You got to watch NWA.
Well, you might get it. We got Tony Schiavone calling the action for MLW.
Yeah, so. You might get it for MLW.
Excellent.
That's very possible.
The Superpowers came out for a promo.
This was awesome.
Nikita hyped up the TV title unification match.
With Eddie Gilbert calling him over and over again.
And then it's time for Dusty to speak. But first, we must see clips.
Can I talk about these clips?
We're going to talk a lot about these clips. If you want to go first, that's fine. I got a lot to say.
It's Hiro Matsuda against Dusty Rhodes, okay? The match starts. Hiro Matsuda takes the dreaded Oriental Salt. Dusty claims it's Oriental Salt. Not just any salt going to go in his eyes.
No.
He throws the salt in the eyes, and he proceeds to attack Dusty Rhodes with karate chops and nerve holds to the titty.
Brian, what was he doing?
Karate chops. He was chopping and chopping and squeezing his titties.
And it's Dusty, so
I think
he was.
I saw some milk.
Dusty makes a big comeback and puts on the Weaver Lock. This is the whole fucking match, everybody, okay?
This is not highlights.
This is the Dusty Rhodes Shogun match we've been waiting for. The whole match is Shogun throws salt in his eyes, chops him, and squeezes titties, and then Dusty makes a comeback and puts him in the fucking Weaver Lock. That's the whole goddamn match, and then Luger runs in. It was still perfect. It was fucking perfect. And then Dusty explains to us, this is why this match must be inside a steel cage. I was like, everything I've ever said bad about you, Dusty, I apologize. You're a fucking genius, and this is a great angle!
So to recap, just some stuff you
Who
missed.
Calls the titty lock, if you're in there?
Shivani.
The heel?
So the question is, do you? One of two things must happen. Either Hiro Matsuda must say, I'm gonna grab your titty. Or Dusty says, grab them titties. Those are the only options. Right?
Watch the titties.
Watch the titties.
Maybe he just grabbed. Yeah, watch the titties.
So.
take over, get it again.
This
the titty again.
So Hiro Matsuda's out there. I have probably in my life somewhere seen another guy who wrestles in trunks with no knee pads and no boots. But I can't think of any. So this is the closest I've ever seen to a guy really in his underwear pretending to fight.
Sure.
And there's
I mean, Snuka.
Yeah, knee pads.
I guess he did, yeah.
Yeah.
Damn it.
So, and he beat my ass, but he's not a young man.
50.
Yeah.
Talked about this last week.
There's an old man in his underwear pretending to fight. He runs wild with...
Boy, was he pretending.
What I will...
Grab Dusty by the titties.
What I was a little more discreet. I said armpit pinch.
Oh, get out of here.
But then when Dusty made his comeback and his throwing punches and Hero's selling them, this was one of those moments where it hits you. People believe this was real.
Yeah.
That's impossible.
So you're telling me that you found it more fake Hiro Matsuda selling than him putting a titty hold on Dusty Rhodes?
Actually,
that was
yes.
Incapacitating the
yes.
fucking guy.
There might be a pressure point there for all I know. I can buy that more. So Dusty puts.
Wait till the next Christmas show.
Dusty puts Matsuda.
We're gonna find out.
Dusty puts Matsuda in the Weaver Lock. Weaver puts JJ in the Weaver Lock, and then Lex Luger hits the ring for the DQ. And Dusty says, "I got to deal with the Shogun. I got to deal with Lex Luger. Now I got to deal with Dick Murdoch, too. And I promise you, Ronnie Garvin's going to win the title at Starrcade."
So the best thing on the show. I'd say by far.
Wilbur's pretty great.
That's true, but this was better.
This was better than I remembered.
This sucked. Rick Ryder, Robbie Idol versus the New Breed. Long-ass, boring fucking match. New Breed wins. Anything? Anyone wants to add anything?
This was so boring. Yeah. The announcers just start wishing happy birthday to random people.
Yeah.
What's that one coach's name? Who are you talking about? You know, that coach we used to know. Oh, yeah, that coach. It went on forever.
So there's a woman in the crowd that called for a super kick. So Chris Champion did one. And then she kept calling for Sean Royal to come off the top rope. So he did.
Yep.
That was it.
This is the point in the show where I actually wrote down, this show sucks. And I've never written that about an NWA show before.
Wow.
Ricky Morton of the Rock and Roll Express is exactly what the graphic read. Versus Joe Lynn.
Low-level Magnum TA here. This Joe Lynn.
So low, I didn't recognize it.
Shittiest tape job you've ever seen. There's just like tape hanging from him. Keep in mind, he would have just come from the locker room.
Yeah.
This was not the end of a grueling match.
He was probably in the locker room, you know, playing cribbage. And as he's walking out, they say, "Wait, Ricky, your shoulder."
Cribbage.
Oh, shit, right. They did play cribbage in the day.
Yeah.
The day.
Vinny used to play cribbage with Ricky or with Richie Bagnin,
that's right.
Buddy.
Kicked my ass a lot. So, Ricky outright says, "Yes, we were the Texas Cowboys. We had to put masks on. It's the only way the Midnights would agree to face us in a match. But there's no way you can avoid us in that scaffold match at Starrcade." Eddie Gilbert versus Tony Suber.
Hold on a minute. There was a Ricky, this Ricky promo. Am I the only one that noticed that he slurred his way through this entire promo? Am I imagining
things? When I said playing cribbage, that was a euphemism.
I see.
This is also...
Well, when I was talking about you playing cribbage, that was not a euphemism.
No, I actually
you
was.
You were playing cribbage.
I was playing cribbage, everyone.
I got it.
Yeah. Ricky Morton may have been abusing substances of some one kind or another.
I have never seen him do a promo like this before. Yeah. I couldn't understand a fucking... He may have been speaking Greek.
Was it worse than Koloff's?
Yes.
I couldn't understand a word that he said either.
Yeah, but
Koloff was just doing a bad Russian accent.
Yeah, he was pretending to be a Russian.
Yeah.
Ricky was pretending to be sober.
And Ivan did a better job of pretending. Eddie Gilbert versus Tony Suber. Eddie came out to the generic guitar riff that would soon become Sting's music for years. They tried to do amateur wrestling like they were the Briscoes.
Oh my God, it was horrific.
What? That like overhook full Nelson thing that he had?
Where he pulled the guy on top of him?
Yes.
Yeah, not a good hold.
He's pulling guard.
He was on his back.
Face up. So Eddie won with a hot shot. And I will say this, everyone booed Eddie. Usually like with the horse who can't win, there's boos and cheers. Eddie was the biggest heel on the show. They hated him. Kevin Sullivan promo. I can't wait for this fucking Nassau show. It's the same thing every week.
Sullivan just out
there.
There's
a trap, Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah,
watch your back in Nassau. I have a feeling in my gut the mind of J.J. Dillon has something planned for you.
Cool.
We know you're going to backstab him, Kevin. Just do it. Let's get it done.
Was it necessary for him to run down the entire Starrcade card before he addressed
they
Dusty Rhodes?
They did give him a lot of time to kill before making his point. And it is the same thing every week. Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson versus Keith Steinborn and Rex King. Went like a minute. Horseman moment with a double gourd buster.
Cool.
Ric Flair comes out for a promo.
Well, listen, I gotta say, all this time we've been watching NWA, this Dusty Rhodes storyline, I know I said I'd take back everything bad I said about the guy. I'm over that now. This is the dumbest fucking storyline. where if Dusty loses, his career is over for 90 days. Flair's out here trying to sell this. Oh, my God. It would make my life if I separated Dusty Rhodes from professional wrestling for 90 days. This is the shittiest angle ever.
So he talks about how Ronnie Garvin's driving around in his pickup truck with fat broads. Now he's got to walk the aisle in Chicago and face the man. As he's talking, they cut to the crowd, and there's always women smiling at the horseman. Either just having fun, or they really think he's hot, or whatever. There was a woman in this crowd who was ready to faint. She's going to black out. Ric Flair was so hot. And Flair says there'll be 5 or 6 million women getting ready for that Nassau show. Then he said, and this is a direct quote, he won't tell the girls who he's going to give it to in Chicago until that night.
What's so weird about this is, like, I've noticed before with Flair, when he's a champion, he does promos like this. When he's a challenger, he doesn't. He's deadly serious competitor Ric Flair that needs to win the title back, because without the title, he's not Ric Flair. He is not doing that this time. He's doing these promos like he dropped the belt to a geek and he's going to win it back in like 3 weeks and no one's going to remember it.
That is accurate.
Just basically what happened. Except for the fact that it occurred.
Terry Taylor versus Curtis Thompson. Terry won with a figure four. Whoopty shit.
Whoa, I wrote down all the moves in the match.
Did you really?
Yes. There was a back suplex, a knee to the face, a neck breaker, and a figure four.
Thank you for that.
Did you do that for every match, Tom, or was there a reason that you thought, Terry Taylor's here, I must write down every move he's going to do in this match?
It was because the match was over in 20 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah. That is a detailed breakdown. So now if you have a match coming up with Terry Taylor, you know the four moves to scout. These are his four favorite holds. So they go to cut a promo.
Terry, I got a question for you. Right. Are there two men, bigger contrast in personalities, than Terry Taylor and Eddie Gilbert?
Not this night.
Because even the rock and rolls, Morton's not that good a promo. Terry Taylor was so goddamn boring. Eddie Gilbert
was
so
good.
Full of life and exciting. Really, Tom?
Yeah, he said Ivan Koloff has a big upper body, but he's got legs like a piano. And if you've seen his legs, he'll figure four him. Makes perfect sense to me.
You had so much more energy and charisma than Terry Taylor did here.
Dude.
Well.
He was very boring. Eddie was full of life, as you noted. He's going to take care of Sting and Jimmy Garvin and Michael Hayes all by himself. He's got great partners in the legend Larry Zbyszko and Rick Steiner, but he'll take care of these guys just one on three. And then I'm going to go be in Terry Taylor's corner, and we're going to beat Nikita Koloff in that TV title match.
Don't you mean Rob Rick Steiner?
Only Michael Hayes called him that.
Huh, how about that?
Yeah.
Crazy.
Then Tony plugged some shows for a while, and thankfully the show ended.
Yeah, that wasn't a very good show.
That was a very bad show.
Couple of highlights, but, man, that was it.
We watched, between these two shows, 2 hours of programming. There might have been 15 good minutes.
Dude, 2 hours and 30 minutes. NWA is 90 minutes. The Rumble was an hour.
Well, there you go, then.
Dude, that was a rough one. Tom, how'd your girl do tonight?
Oh, she won.
Yeah.
I thought you were asking about my wife, because she's not doing too good after that Saints game.
That's too bad.
Likes the Saints?
Yeah.
Are they from Poland?
No, but seeing as she is French, she was drawn to the fleur-de-lis that adorns their logo.
Wow. Is that really why?
What do you think? I made
that
up.
Why wouldn't it be?
I don't know. It's weird to me. Liking a team. Hey, I got a song for everybody. Ready? It's about the Hall of Awesome.
All right.
I don't even know what that is.
You know what we need to do, you and me? We need to start. There already is a Hall of Fame, and that's fine. It can be there. We don't need to counter it. But we also need to start the Hall of Awesome.
The F4W Hall of Awesome.
Here's the only criteria. Are you awesome?
Unquestionably awesome. Not everybody goes into the Hall of Awesome.
Here, here.
It is time now for the newest inductees into the Hall of Awesome. Oh, man, we can use this every week. Well, unfortunately, in the 2 hours and 30 minutes of wrestling that we watched this week, not one man qualified for the Hall of Awesome.
No.
So I guess maybe we'll have to wait until next time.
I would say us for getting through it.
Yeah. Hey, Tom, let's do some plugs, dude.
Not much going on coming up. I think the next show I'm working is MLW, February 8th. Like I said, take it on MVP in the first round of the world title tournament. So,
holy smokes, you could be how are you at, if you won this, you'd be the world champion of two promotions? How's that even possible? How can you have two world champions? You'd have to unify your own championships.
If anybody could do it, I could.
That's true. Well, good luck with that, Tom.
Maybe it's like multi-dimensions.
Could be. You could take this MVP guy. Just don't have Seth in your corner. I hear he let you down. I'm sorry.
Rough memories there?
At Filthy Tom Lawler on Twitter, everybody.
Instagram as well.
Instagram as well. Did you put up the video from your interview from MLW where you and Seth were pummeling as you did your promo? Is that up there?
No, that's on the broadcast.
Oh, man. You'll have to check that out, everybody. And Tom and I will be back on Wednesday, Royal Rumble 2010 SmackDown. And I guess either Geek of the Week or the Chopping Block. We'll have to figure it out.
When does Mixed Match Challenge begin?
Tuesday. No, Tom. Oh, please. Please. Must we?
Well, I was hoping it started later, and then it was only 20 minutes.
It's Tuesday night starts.
Yeah, we'll skip it.
Maybe I'll assign Vinny to that one.
Well, for the potpourri, right? How many weeks does it last?
Maybe this week's potpourri, we'll watch a 1
20-minute show.
Mixed Match Challenge.